Kurtz, Marsh, Randolph, Shabazz, Pivot, Council President Small, we have four, let us stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. The Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll now have invocation by the Honorable Councilman Jesse Kurtz.
Let us pray. Creator of all things, true source of light and wisdom, lofty source of all being, graciously let a ray of your brilliance penetrate into the darkness of our understanding, and take from us the double darkness in which we have been born, sin and ignorance. Give us a sharp sense of understanding, a retentive memory, and the ability to grasp things correctly and fundamentally. Grant us the talent of being exact in our explanations, and the ability to express ourselves with thoroughness and charm. Point out the beginning, direct the progress, and help in its completion. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
As we noted, the proceedings have been provided as required by law by the city clerk, sending to the press and the Philadelphia Inquirer on January 6, 2017, and published on January 9, 2017, and also to the Star Ledger on January 19, 2017, and published on January 21, 2017. A list of the meetings for the Council of the City of Atlantic City, including notice of the meeting scheduled for January 25, 2017 at 5 p.m. in the Hank Kiner Council Chambers, 2206 City Hall, 1301 Baccarat Boulevard, and also a copy of said notice was posted by the City Clerk on the bulletin board, main lobby, first floor on the same date. All of the aforesaid complies with NJSA 10:4-6 SEC, known as the Open Public Meetings Law, and NJSA 40:69A-179. This is the regular council meeting of the City Council of Atlantic City. Before we begin, please be aware of our rules in this chamber. All persons are to be seated unless all seats are filled, in which case you may stand against the wall in orderly fashion. We are asking that all gentlemen remove their hats. All persons are to remain quiet during these proceedings. This is so that everyone is able to hear what is going on. Please turn off all cell phones or set them to silence. No one shall speak unless they are invited to do so by the Council President. Shouting, interrupting, speaking out of turn, or acting disorderly in any fashion will not be tolerated, and anyone doing so will be removed from the meeting. When and if you are invited to the microphone to speak, state your name and address. You will be allotted 3 minutes for comment. Please respect the time for other persons and end your speech within the 3 minutes allowed. If it is your intention to ask a question of council, you will be permitted to ask a maximum of 2 questions. Your questions are to be clearly stated, and after the questions are asked, you are to take your seat. The council president will determine if the question can be answered and by whom. Finally, please understand that there will be no personal attacks or name calling. If you do so, your time will immediately be cut short and you may be asked to leave. Council President, have we any committee reports?
Yes, Health and Human Services, Licensing and Inspections, and Information Technology met. We had the opportunity to meet the acting director of our Management Information Systems, BJ Verma, reviewed with him kind of the state of things with technology and set some goals for the upcoming year, put some idea of possible goals for getting us to where we can improve the basic workflow of things, but then also try to borrow from some of the best practices. Like, for example, he does some work with the Camden County Public Safety IT, and they've been noted for having some great practices when it comes to the technology side, and so there's some things that we might be able to use to incorporate that into our affairs here in Atlantic City. There's several items on the agenda with regard to licensing and inspections. I want to let the members of the public know that I'm pulling Ordinance 1C, like Charlie. We're going to bring that back to the committee. I want to thank the people from the public who reached out when they saw that with some concerns, and encourage anybody from the public, and when you're reading the agenda, to contact myself or anybody up here. Email us. Our email addresses, phone numbers are up on the website, so we can make these things better. We're going to bring back into committee. With regard to the jitney route, wanted to get on the record that if that's approved, the couple blocks that are being added, we're going to need to add some signs. That was brought to our attention. So we have to make sure that not only the two spots in the inlet, but the entire route is adequately marked with signs. So I hope that when that goes, if that goes through, we do an entire review of all the routes just to make sure the members of the public know what the route is and everything is clear with regard to signage. And that's my report.
Marsh.
Mr. President, the Planning and Development Committee met at their regular meeting, and as a result, we have a four. Can you hear me now?
Speak loud.
Mr. Goodman, you don't do that. The Planning and Development Committee met, Mr. President, and we have four items for consideration. My colleagues, I would ask for their support. They're all authorizations to submit grants, which are no money from the city budget. And I also want to report, Mr. President, that our meeting was only 35 minutes long because someone was not here. That's my report.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Revenue on Finance, we met on Tuesday the 17th. We created three duplicate tax sale certificates, corrected property assessment and tax credits, went over two small items for a temporary budget, which included reimbursement for CRDA for our Class 2 officers, a couple of FEMA projects. The city will be having two auctions on February 23rd. We have an audit contract from Ford Scott and Associates. We also have our budget consultant, Ken Moore, and we just renewed property insurance and casualty insurance that broke the record. Those will be entertained tonight as well. Yesterday, I traveled to Trenton, New Jersey for our budget meeting. Well, it was a meeting between the city and the state, the various firms, and we just kind of wanted to get on the same page because we all know last year wasn't your traditional budget year. Without, you know, getting into too much specifics, this proposal looking to be around $211 million for the budget. I did ask the state flat. I said, with everything that we know that's going on with the city of Atlantic City, the fact that the city wanted to come in with no tax increase is their goal and their mission to not saddle the residents of Atlantic City with another tax increase. And they said they couldn't make any promises. But once the budget is turned over to us, it's in city council's hands, regardless of the oversight, you know, we can see fit to make the budget when we want to make it. And if the state sees fit otherwise, I mean, that's their prerogative under the legislation. I think it's important that, you know, it's everyone's goal in this room to stop the bleeding. The residents have suffered enough, and, you know, it's up to us to continue to do our due diligence to, you know, at minimum, keep things flat, but it's time, you know, for a decrease. So I just want to share that with everyone. Also, last year during negotiations, around the time, back and forth with the state, the early retirement came out of that session. We don't know where it's going to go. We're hearing conflicting reports. But one thing that the state didn't even entertain, and I asked Director Cunningham, Ron Israel, and the other stakeholders from the state, that we get a meeting with the Board of Education. And I think we've seen the numbers of the early retirement here with the city upwards over 150 people. I think you'll see that same type of mass exodus, if not more, from the Board of Education. Not only from administrators, but you have teachers who have been there 30 plus years that, you know, are making a high six-figure salary. So it's important to understand the totality of the whole Atlantic City taxpayer, not just focusing on what we do over here in the city, because as you know, when you pay your taxes, you're paying, you know, the schools as well. So that's something that I'm reaching out to the board president and administration over there tomorrow, as I told you guys. And let's just do our due diligence and investigate, you know, the numbers to see what it will be. I know there's no control over the schools, but, you know, working in partnership with the Atlantic City taxpayer in mind, I think it's a, you know, it's a benefit for everyone to do their due diligence on their part. And lastly, literally as we were sitting there, the news broke of the Assemblyman, Speaker Prieto, asking for a $2 room tax, which I wholeheartedly support. During my entire time up here, I've always screamed for the state of New Jersey, and anybody who would listen, to return some of the taxes here to the city and its taxpayers. And I'm just glad that, you know, we have a little traction now on the state level. Hopefully those legislators do the right thing and keep the Atlantic City taxpayer in mind. And, you know, it's a start. It's not the number that we want, but at least we're having a conversation. It's a start. And, you know, hopefully working in concert, you know, we'll get much more initiatives like that done. And that's my report.
Council President, do we know when the budget will be turned over to us? Did we specify when?
Well, and I was very adamant about that. We're looking at sometime in February. This wasn't a meeting where it was, you know, discuss meat and potatoes. We won't cut here. It was just to get everybody in one room. And as soon as I get, you know, all those numbers in the budget and the budget with details, I'll make sure that as soon as I get it, that it's forwarded to each and every one of you. One thing I did forget, and it's very, very, very important. I said, as I stated throughout the whole process, the state can't take over Atlantic City and not take over Atlantic City's problem. So it's like it's your problem now too. And I asked about state aid, which is extremely important. And the figures that I got is roughly around $69.2 million, which is roughly around about 21 million short from last year. As you know, with the transitional aid, there was some debate back and forth. We ended up getting $26.2 million, and I was told that that was a one-time award. So it looks like our transitional aid will go back down to $13 million. It's $20.2 million. When we get the IET, the ACA funds, that's around $14 million. Energy receipts around $6.2 million, so for a total of $69.2 give or take. So once we get that and we know where we are, it's up to us to make deeper cuts. And, you know, I'm just going to encourage the Revenue and Finance Committee that, you know, we have a yeoman's job to do, and I'm sure that everyone is up to the task.
One more question, so we have it clear. Is it the state that has our budget at this current moment, or the administration that has it?
No, well, by law, the administration, it's still in their hands, but once it's turned over to us, unless the state is going to, you know, tell us different, it comes to city council.
So my question would be to the administration. When do you guys anticipate council getting the budget for 2017?
Based on the findings, when we go back to Trenton on February 15th, if we can lock in what the income is going to be by the end of February or the first meeting of March, we'll present today's draft budget to City Council.
The income from who?
Income from the state and from the casinos, from the IETs, from the ACA, and from Concert TA and Essential Services.
You want to chime in? Did I misspeak or misspoke?
No, Council President, I don't think you misspoke. I think the meeting was a good first step in terms of working on the budget together. Both the city's executive and legislative branches were represented along with the state. But to through Council President Yu to Councilman Gilliam, I think that the city, there's a lot of unknowns relative to the budget before it can be transmitted to the council. As the mayor said, there's questions over the IET amounts to be received. There's questions over certain expense line items. But we worked with your professionals, and you have a very good team in your finance department who had a list of issues that we need to go over. They're finalizing the annual financial statement, and that gets submitted to the division that I oversee, as all municipalities do, for approval. Once the annual financial statement's settled, that'll start as the building block for what the next year's budget looks like. My goal, which I think the council president and mayor share, is that we can't get to the same position we were in last year, where we didn't adopt the city's budget until November. The reason for that is because it affects your tax revenues, the conducting of an accelerated tax sale. So we agreed to work together and meet routinely. And as the mayor said, I don't know what the exact date is, but we agreed to convene again in mid-February. So there's a lot of variables that have to be settled in. I'm sure I'm not thinking of all of them, but there were quite a number of blanks. But as the AFS gets done and some other things come into picture, you know, the obvious intent is to get the budget done in a more timely fashion than it was last year.
Director Cunningham, we realized that when the student came and occupied other municipalities, they came in with a check in hand. I'm wondering why the state of New Jersey hasn't actually brought up the concept of a check that's going to help us with the shortfall, because I can remember, I believe, North, somewhere around $1 billion. You had Camden, when you did that, it was $175 million. Is there any appetite from the state to actually come up with a number that helps fill out budgetary restraints?
Councilman, I'm not sure that a check for $1 billion or $100 and whatever million to Camden were was provided. Newark receives $10 million in transitional aid. Camden receives $9 million in transitional aid. I may have that number wrong. Atlantic City received $26 million last year, which was the most of any transitional aid municipality. So I think that we are obviously committed to the city's financial well-being, and I didn't bring my checkbook tonight.
And
might be in my other suit.
And lastly, which can affect the budget, you know, a few million hand in. This year, we found out that on the $38 million in pension and health owed in 2015, that the city can start paying that next year, and there's even some talk about possibly phasing it in over 5 years, which will be of help. And the last big thing, which is went from the 800-pound gorilla to the 8,000-pound gorilla, was Borgata. The attorneys were very tight-lipped, but they said that hopefully sometime in the next week or so, we should have some good news in regards to settling Borgata, which is an essential figure in the city's debt. That's it.
I have a follow-up question. Director Cunningham, at this point, has Borgata committed to paying their share of the pilot for this fiscal year?
Councilman, I haven't had any personal conversations with Borgata, and the parties that have are council, and I'm reluctant to say anything for fear of saying the wrong thing. So, unfortunately, I'm not able to answer your question.
Has there been a contingency plan developed at this point in the event that they don't make their share of the pilot?
I imagine that the contingency plan, if they don't make their share of the pilot, you're talking in terms of, Councilman, let me just make sure I understand your question.
Sure.
Is the question, are they going to pay the pilot, or as opposed to paying ad valorem taxes, or are they going to offset against amounts owed? Are they going to offset amounts owed to them against the pilot payment?
Exactly, the latter.
The latter?
The latter part, for the benefit of the public, I want to know, is Borgata going to actually give us money, or are they going to take a credit, in essence, and then we end up in a cash flow problem? But with that aside, Director, that is my question.
Part of the same negotiations regarding the overall settlement, so unable to comment on it at this time.
I mean, I think that's the goal, because that's possibly north of $30 million in revenue that the city can add in this coffers, versus someone saying, okay, well, you owe me, I'm going to skip this and basically take an informal credit. So that's why, we were trying to get that settled as fast as possible.
Council President, I think the only thing that was basically, it was going through my mind was, did the state allocate any monies to to assist us in the situation, or was it solely relying on legislation that was tapping into the different taxations and the different funding streams that should have been part of Atlantic City's funding stream anyway? The discussion was about the monies that were allocated when you came and took over different municipalities. Those legislations were in effect the vehicle to help with those with that debt. So in our situation, we understand it's a little bit different, but I'm wondering, was there any money in the first place to help us out? Or was it basically relying on what legislation was pending? Because right now, we're in this position right now, we're probably facing a hole. And I think it seems to me that it could be strategic. So I don't know. I'm kind of speculative about this, but it could be strategic.
And Councilman, to your point, that's why I asked for, because I mean, it's simple mathematics. Mm-hmm. That's why I asked for the total amount of transition aid, and we ran down line by line what we think that the city will receive. Because it's important that we don't give another tax increase to the residents of Atlantic City. That was my first question outside of the box. Like, you know, can the state commit to doing that? Right. With everything going on,
I totally agree. My fear is, Council President, forgive me for interrupting. Yeah. My fear is that there's an arm of the legislation that suggests that we were mandated to raise rates, taxation wise. And I'm fearful that, again, that the residents have to pay for this exuberant amount of money.
And that was the controversy from last year, because, you know, some towns say that transitional aid didn't come with strings attached as far as a tax increase, and that's why at the last minute there was a tax increase levied upon the residents of Atlantic City.
Thank you. As far as we got it, are we negotiating to cut, or are we trying to basically pay Borgata and hold for what we owe them? Because I'm of the mindset that if the state was allowed them to be taxed at 800 and something million, and then they sold for 900 million, which makes them a $1.8 billion entity, are we talking to them in terms of that real number? Because right now we're only talking to them from the perspective of an old assessment.
Councilman, Borgata has perfected judgments for various tax years that neither the city nor the state may agree with some of the assessments, but those court decisions have been rendered. So the discussions with them are looking at the universe of the claims that are settled and the years that are unsettled, because the tax court applied certain provisions of the Freeze Act. So we don't have discretion in terms of what the courts say they're owed. So the discussion with Borgata is ultimately trying to find a solution that works financially for the city of Atlantic City, given the cash crunch that is advanced down here.
So have we had any discussion from a state perspective in terms of trying to figure out a different formula in which we tax casinos, so we won't be finding ourselves in the same position? And number two, have anybody discussed any changing of the pilot? Because there's some language in the pilot that also pretty much puts the city in a compromising position.
I think the answer to the first question is the pilot, because the purpose of the pilot, as I understood it, was to remove the volatility of casino tax appeals. I'm not exactly sure, with respect to your second question, which elements of the pilot you're referring to, but I'd be happy to talk to you about that.
And I know it's legislation, and you know sometimes things are hard to be overturned, but I know that the state, and correct me if I'm wrong, has been working diligently with the properties, quote, pre-pilot, on getting some of those numbers down on what the city was owed, so moving forward, so there's no tax appeals, period, because by the legislation with the pilot. So, anybody else, any other questions? All right, move the agenda.
Communications and petitions are listed on the agenda but will not be read into the record. This brings us to resolutions of recognition. We do have 10 on the agenda. I believe we have at least 4 here for
let's group the other six that are here. May I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Move by Gillian, second by Shabazz.
So the grouping will include resolutions 19, 23, 55, and Thomas Battles here. Greg DiPiano here. And 55, 56, 57, and 58 will be included in the group. And resolution 19 is a resolution of condolence to the family of Marsh Farmer. 23, condolence to the family of Gertrude Trudy Harewood Jenkins. 55 is recognition of Thomas L. Battles, student of Kappa Alpha Phi fraternity. 56 is a resolution commending Gregory DiPiano. 57 is a resolution recognizing Michael Bailey on his retirement. And 58 is a resolution recognizing Pastor Eric McCoy. Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes.
That's nine in the affirmative. The first resolution we have is number 43, recognizing the life of Sheila Kowenski and supporting her dream of erecting a Holocaust memorial on the Atlantic City boardwalk.
May I have a motion?
Move it.
Second. Move by Randall, second by Shabazz. Questions? Call the vote.
Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes.
That's nine in the affirmative, and we do have a presentation.
She's smiling down from heaven. So we appreciate it very much.
Yes, very good to see you.
Thank you. God bless.
Resolution 54 is a recognition of Jacob Lawrence and his contribution to the art world.
Mr. President, if I can, I didn't even want to be, I just wanted the audience to be aware. First, Sheila Kowenski was a Holocaust survivor who passed away, and she's one of the last Holocaust survivors in this area. Secondly, Jacob Lawrence, a lot of people don't know, was born in Atlantic City at 1522 Artie Avenue, and Jacob Lawrence is one of the premier artists in America. In fact, one of his pictures hangs in the green room in the White House, and he is famous for doing a series of 60 pictures called The Migration, which documented the movement of African Americans from the South to the urban North. So I just wanted to, the Art Center Commission is going to have a month-long celebration of his life and some of his portraits in the fall of this year. So I just wanted the council and citizens to be aware such a great artist was born in Atlantic City and brought such great distinction to the world of art in America.
Move it.
Second. Move by Gilliam, second by Marsh. Call.
Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes.
That's nine in the affirmative. We have resolution 59.
They're going to receive it too.
Thank you very much for Jacob Lawrence. I just wanted to say, I tried this project years ago, and other people before me to no avail. And I almost gave up the court around December until I got a phone call, and got some money to do this project and everything. Yes, Mr. Lawrence was born in 1522, 3rd Ward, Artie Avenue. And I found some interesting information I'm going to share with the public. I found the oral history 1968 by Carol Green, interviewed by 100-page oral history. And he asked Mr. Lawrence, I'm paraphrasing, what inspired you to do this kind of work? He said, he named three Mexican painters. And he said he believed that he liked their work with social realism. And then he asked a question, what kind of style of art did you really like? During that time, it's Picasso, modern art. He said abstract art. So he liked to use tempera paints, which is the process is hard, it's not like oils, and he did it his entire life. And he also did pattern in his work. His work is unique if you see how it was done, and vibrant colors. And I think he got a lot of his history because his parents did come from, father came from South Carolina, and mother came from Virginia to seek work in Atlantic City. And ended up met in Atlantic City and got married. That's how it came about. So I want to say thank you, and we located some original works of Lawrence. Four works will be on loan, so we will work on that in the detail probably by May. Thank you very much.
Resolution 59 is a resolution recognizing Assistant Chief Thomas Flanagan, Firefighter Martin Basso, Firefighter Stephen Duran, Firefighter Torian Perry, and Firefighter Artie Freeman.
Move it.
I have a motion.
Second. Move it.
Move by Randolph.
Second by Shabazz.
Second by Shabazz.
Chang?
Yes. Question? What do they do and why are we, it'd be nice to let the public know their achievement, just because if they did, I mean.
Did you read it directly?
Something like this, I think people.
Whereas Atlantic City firefighters not only protect and serve the Atlantic City community, but assist the community in numerous ways. Whereas in December 2016, during the Christmas holidays, the members of Engine Number 1 took time from their regular duties as firefighters to spread joy and cheer to the Atlantic City community. Whereas the members of Engine 1 traveled to Bungalow Park and picked up Councilman Randolph. Firefighter Artie Freeman, who was appropriately dressed as Santa Claus, along with Assistant Chief Thomas Flanagan, Firefighter Martin Basso, Firefighter Stephen Duran, and Firefighter Dorian Perry, dressed as Santa's elves, knocked on neighborhood doors passing out candy canes. Whereas the kind-hearted efforts of these firefighting professionals demonstrates their commitment to service in the Atlantic City community beyond what they are required to do. And now therefore be it resolved that the City Council of the City of Atlantic City hereby commends Assistant Chief Thomas Flanagan, Firefighter Martin Basso, Firefighter Stephen Duran, Firefighter Torian Perry, and Firefighter Artie Freeman for their kind and compassionate service to the children of Atlantic City.
There are other firefighters that pretty much participated in that too, and at some point, if we can get their names included, but if we could say all the firefighters that participated in the various areas of Atlantic City, would be ideal. I don't know the names of them, but I do know that there was other engines that pretty much participated in giving out toys. It would be a disservice to actually remiss those guys who did it as well. But that's more another thing. We make sure we actually get those names of that other engines as well.
But thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randolph?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbett?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes.
That's 9 in the affirmative.
Listen, I just wanted to say that if there were other firefighters, but I took time to get their names because they did come when I asked them to come, and I really appreciate it. And I did say that I wanted to recognize you, and I really wanted to do it publicly because it was cold that night. I caught a cold that night. But we got the job done, and you made a lot of kids happy that night. So. Thank you. If Artie was a second Santa Claus, he wasn't a body, so we'll correct that. Okay. All right.
Thank you. Councilor President.
Yes.
I just want to thank the firefighters and all the firefighters. People, you know, the Atlantic City firefighters, they really give back. They go through the entire city. The amount of toys that you give out throughout the entire city is amazing. The looks on those kids' face when you guys pull up with that truck with the music playing and let them have at it, picking their toys. It's probably one of the greatest things I enjoy at Christmas is watching you guys show up and do that with the kids. So thank you very much for all the work you do. And your union as a whole that did it throughout the whole city, please tell them thank you and we truly appreciate it.
Next year, we're going to do the whole ward.
Hopefully, we'll do that.
All right,
hopefully.
Oh, whoa!
Well, you know, we're part of the 100.
I know.
Nice little plug, huh? It's appropriate.
We're at the bridge.
We have resolution 60, and this is a resolution supporting Stop the Heroin.
Move it. May I have a motion?
Second.
Move by Gillian, second by Marsh, Shabazz, third by Randolph.
Whereas Stop the Heroin is an organization that helps recent rehab graduates to transition into a sober living environment. And whereas the use of heroin has reached epidemic proportions in the state of New Jersey and in Atlantic County. And whereas Stop the Heroin was born out of the tragic death of Stephen Schmincke of Egg Harbor Township, and was founded by his parents who decided to turn their tragedy into constructive action to help others. Whereas the mission of Stop the Heroin is to work with those in need, those who are underprivileged, and those who are underserved to rebuild and restructure. Their focus lies on community efforts, including small-scale construction projects, shelter, food aid, community awareness, and educational opportunities. Whereas Stop the Heroin has taken bold and innovative steps to address the heroin epidemic in Atlantic County, including the creation of Stevens Place, a men's sober living home in Pleasantville. The organization also hosts community awareness events and engages in fundraising for the purposes of supporting the rehabilitative effort to Stop the Heroin. And now therefore be resolved that the City Council of the City of Atlantic City hereby recognizes the significant and valuable efforts of the Stop the Heroin organization and supports its goals. It works to heal the epidemic of heroin use in Atlantic City and surrounding communities. Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randolph?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes.
It's 9 in the affirmative. We have a presentation.
Mayor, Council, thank you very much. We greatly appreciate this. As today we mark the 10 months of my son's passing, we really appreciate the recognition for our continuance of bringing awareness and education to the public and helping the people our organization is able to help out through hard work and fundraising raising and donations through the general public. This means a lot to us as we continue our mission. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. And Council President, I'd like to personally thank them. I think another thing we should get on board with is I can't believe I'm saying this, but the governor's initiative with the opiate problem that we have here is something we all can get behind because, as you all know, we all have friends, family, associates that go in for an operation, and next thing you know, they're hooked on some type of bill or something like that. And this is really a crisis for the city. And when I see people like this that have lost people and fight so that other families can hopefully get in front of this and help their family members. You know, another thing that I really appreciate about people, when you read the obituaries, where now people actually put after a long battle of addiction. Yeah. Right. So it brings awareness. People in their worst times of losing somebody they love, they're telling you that these young children, you know, got involved with drugs so that we could show our children, you know, hey, that one time you tried on the weekend could lead to this at a very young age. So again, thank you. And it's, you know, we need to look into the governor's initiative with the opiate problem that we're having and get behind that as well. If there's anything we could do to implement, you know, and get any information from him as well, because it's one good thing. I'd love to see him go out on a high note with the opiate epidemic.
Hey, Director Cunningham. Are you taking notes that members of City Council agree with the government on?
I am.
I'm I met this this family maybe a year ago. It was one, I think they were first coming out, and the passion that they actually showed and the commitment that they showed when they were in a time of grieving was something I thought that was something to be recognized. But the hard work and diligence actually had them be recognized by the county for their hard work in terms of fighting the addiction. The other important thing I think that the thing that they do is they're pushing heroin addiction as a health issue. And we have to actually jump on board with them to make sure the world understands it's just not party. It's actually a health problem and addiction. Anytime you're talking about opiate, that's not something that you can just stop because there's other mechanisms that's in that chemical that you have to have it. And I think that more we get behind folks like this and other larger initiatives, because we know Atlantic City, God knows, has its share of heroin. It's been a nemesis for our community. I personally thank you because when I spoke with you the first time, you guys actually touched something in me because everyone in every family has had someone who's battling some kind of drug addiction. I just wanted to personally thank you for your resilience, your strength, and anything that we can do to help you succeed and help others be aware of this drug. We're 100% with you. Thank you.
Mr. President, just briefly, I agree with all my colleagues' statements with regard to Spanish. They're doing tremendous work. But just one thing, I think we, with the governor's program, I agree with it, but there's a element of the governor's program I think that we have to look at, and hopefully our healthcare professionals look at. There's a provision that says you can only get a 5-day script for the opiates, and that sounds good, but that is going to work a burden on people who are poor or people who are distressed financially, going back and forth to the doctor for 5 days. So while we support that, and it's important, I think we have to look at all aspects of that project. I agree with you. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't hold hard and support that, but we have to look at every segment of the society. And people who are affluent, that's easy to do. But people who are not and don't have the means and still have are saddled with the drug addiction problem have to be looked at. So I want to say that.
Now, Council President, a quick thing. It's a real inspiration to see a family like yours take such a tragedy and turn it into something that can inspire us as elected officials and the people of the community. So thank you for having the strength to do that. It's much appreciated. And on a lighter note, I wanted to commend you on the behavior of your young guests. They're very well behaved, and you're always welcome at the council meeting.
Council President, just wanted to add a little piece to this. I applaud the efforts of everyone who dive into such a dark and destructive element, such as drug addiction. I think too often we get misled to believe that it's not there. You know, we like to believe that, oh, it's not us, it's the druggies. It's not us, it's that community down the block. It's not us, it's them. And that has been very destructive in our community. This community has been affected for drugs for way longer than we'd like to admit. Poverty and drugs always seem to be connected. And now through the hardships that we've had and we're facing right now, folks tend to lean on drugs, unfortunately, as to help cope. Me working in the social services arena, I've had to face quite a lot of challenges for folks along their way, and their struggles are not easy. So for organizations like Stop the Heroin and other organizations that are out there, they need as much help as they possibly can to help in dealing with these dilemmas of drug addiction, hardships, coping mechanisms, what have you. The mental health arena, which is also associated to the medical issue, suffers with these elements as well, because it's one of those areas that are denied. It's huge, and it affects all our communities, and it's affecting our children. More and more of our children are being subjected to areas or being aware of drugs firsthand, and we are losing more and more children to drugs, whether it's the romanticism that we see today in the entertainment world, or it's just accessibility, because too often our children are accessible, or drugs are accessible to these children. a lot, in some arenas, a lot easier than dictionaries or a computer or someone to care for them. So I applaud you. I know the challenge is something that's noble, and I know it's something that we all have to dive into. So I just make the clarion call to help you and help everyone else that's helping others trying to get through that darkness. Because one person addicted is one person too many. So one day, we'll find a solution.
We are up to public comment on Good and Welfare. First, Tom Forkin. Please state your name and address to the microphone, please.
Tom Forkin, 419 Carson Avenue. I wanted to address council tonight as a resident and as an employee in the public schools that, you know, lunch money. If you have a bully taking lunch money from your child, okay, what do? You talk to the teacher, you get the bully to stop taking the money, right? Well, the state takes, what, $90 million a year. We still can't get a number. I was just asking Christian. $90 million a year in luxury room and parking tax. I've been harping on this issue I don't know how long. They're obviously not going to give it back to us. You've exhausted all of your good faith efforts. You guys have done a great job at trying to crunch the budget, but they take $90 million a year, and that's just a standard estimate that I've talked to several other accountants and other money people about, and this is something that needs to change. The same as a bully taking the money. The state has a temerity to come in here and say that we're being fiscally irresponsible when they can't balance a state budget. They've taken billions of dollars out of our city, billions in 30 years. They should pay the Borgata flat out, just pay, be done with it. Give us that revenue flow back to the city, give it to this administration, and earmark it for public safety in the tourism zone. We've said that before too. I'd like to get a number. Maybe the state could give us a number. That's $90 million. And who's it on the back of our taxpayers? We have senior citizens who are being taxed out of their homes regularly. They're on fixed budgets. It's not fair. Now, somewhere along the line, somebody's getting some bad legal advice. Now, I don't know how on God's green earth this would be tantamount to me representing a husband in a divorce and turning around and representing the wife in the post-judgment custody or support issues, that the state can somehow hire our former solicitor and business administrator as their state go-to guy. That's a conflict, okay? Now, you know, I don't want to be disrespectful to any person in the room, but this is a conflict. We need to file a civil rights claim against the state of New Jersey. It's violating our civil rights. It's on the backs of our taxpayers. And the idea that we're going to fire firemen and police officers, let me tell you something, that's a recipe for disaster, because a lot of those guys don't live here. They live out in Summers Point, Northfield, EHT, around the county. They're not going to be able to pay their mortgages. They're not going to be able to pay their bills and their county taxes. So that's a county problem, too. And that's going to be an epidemic. If they think that Atlantic County has the highest foreclosure rate in the country right now, it's only going to get higher. We need to remedy the tax flow issue. And if that tax flow issue is not remedied, we can do all the budget cuts we want. We can create danger to our community by cutting police officer jobs and fireman jobs. But here's the problem. We don't have that income, okay, that we need, and the state takes it. They have to change it, and it has to happen immediately. And the only way that's going to happen is by judicial action.
Thank you, Mr. Walker.
Thank you.
Well, I'll take it.
Yes. Something that Mr. Corkin said rings about the question is, what capacity does, at this moment, does Mr. Holt serve in the overall workings of the city? Right now I see him sitting down in his normal position as our VA. However, I need to understand the dynamics as to who's our VA. If Mr. Holtz is employed by the state, he can't be the state worker in our VA in the same capacity, or can't be.
Who are you directing that question to?
To Director Cunningham.
Okay.
I think
think Mr. Holt is going to continue to serve in the role that he's been serving, which is to administer day-to-day operations of the city. Mr. Holt is a consummate professional in all of this, and it disturbs me that he's being attacked personally by you, Councilman, at all, but by comments made to me prior to this. I think Mr. Holt is a consummate professional. He can continue to play that role, and I don't see a conflict at all.
But at the same time, for the respect of this community, right? You have an individual who, in my mind, Holt was working with the city of Atlantic City, and the professionalism of the man is not the question at hand. The duties of the man is at question. How does he serve two masters? Either he's going to be the BA for the city of Atlantic City, or he's going to be a state conduit. At what point can I work with this gentleman knowing that it's for the best interest of the city when he represents the state?
And it's also important to know for the Atlantic City taxpayer out there, mind, because people have called me with the same questions. He is off the city of Atlantic City's payroll, so his financial responsibility is coming. No, I'm speaking about this. People was asking how he's getting paid, you know, by both sides. He's relieved from the city of Atlantic City taxpayers, so you're not responsible for the business administrator's position.
But he is serving in the capacity, if I did not hear correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Cunningham. You just said he will remain in the capacity in which he's been as the BA, correct?
Yes, he's going to continue to work on the day-to-day operations of the city of Atlantic City.
On whose behalf?
On all of our behalfs.
That's a conflict.
I disagree.
Well, I mean, when I was told the situation, it was clear that the state of New Jersey has taken control of the business administrator's position. So, meaning that he is a state employee. There's no financial. I get where you're going, but I'm talking about as far as people asking questions like, well, is he getting paid by the city? Is he getting paid by the state? Is he getting paid by the city to represent the state? It is clear, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that the funding source is from the state of New Jersey.
Correct.
No longer on the city payroll, that position is vacant. That's what I'm speaking about.
But I don't believe that I'm talking about who he gets paid for. At this point, I don't care who the man gets paid for, but if he's supposed to be representing the city of Atlantic City as a BA, then he should be representing us as that. He cannot be a conduit of the state and then tell us that he's working with us. I don't understand how that works. Maybe I could basically go get a shrink to help me figure that out, but it's confusing to have a person serve two masters,
Mr. President, it can't be done. Let me say something, Mr. President. I think that, and Mr. Holt can obviously speak for himself, Director Cunningham is correct. Mr. Holt is a professional.
Excuse me.
As I forestated, Mr. Holt is a professional. It does make a difference because we're talking about somebody performing a specific duty in a specific situation. And it does speak to someone's professionalism when they have the ability to perform a duty. We have a different situation than a lot of municipalities in Atlantic City. The state has taken over, so I think we have to come into reality, and people can say what they want. The bottom line is that there's no more city versus state. We already litigated that. Those of us who took a position against the state takeover verbally for over a year and demonstrated that we did not want the city to take over, that didn't happen. The state did take over. That's a fact. So when Mr. Holt has the ability to work for the state, the question of city versus state is over. And we might not like that, but that's the situation that we're in terms of how we work operationally. Hopefully, very soon, we won't have that situation because we'll have a new governor. And the new governors, the people running for governor, has said they're going to turn over the takeover of Atlantic City. Before the situation that we are right in now, I don't see the conflict, and I don't see the question. The question right now is, how do we get out of the situation we're in? How do we get away from state control? And Mr. Holt, being a state employee and functioning operationally, I don't see how that's a conflict with the city of Atlantic City moving forward, which is the question. The question of that we litigated about state takeover, a lot of people who are taking positions now, they didn't take a position then. That question has been litigated. The state is taking over, and I know that the question of whose interest people are working in has already been litigated.
Okay,
he was the city attorney.
Excuse me, Mr. Forkin. Excuse me. Listen. Just like in any debate or any argument in your home or anywhere else, everybody's going to have a fair chance to say what they want to say. There's no outbursts. We didn't interrupt anyone from the public. We're not going to interrupt council members from the bodies. And Mr. Forkin, I'm sure you wouldn't have that when they come in front of the ABC board, right?
I give you two more minutes.
That's cool. All right. Councilman Marsh, you're next.
I don't think it's a question about integrity. I don't think it's a question about professionalism. I don't think it's a question about who that man is. I need to know the question that Councilman Gilliam asked.
Yes.
The community needs to know.
Correct.
And for Councilman Shabazz said, because the state has taken over, so be it. No, we just need to know what the issue is. I don't think it's you take him out of the situation. The question still needs to be asked. Who works for who, on whose behalf, and that's what I need to know, and I'm sure everybody else out there needs to know. It ain't got nothing to do with what he brings to the table. What he can do, because I'm thoroughly confident in any capacity he works in, including the state or the city. I think the people need an explanation, because it came on like a dad-born tornado. It came, and nobody knew, had no hour to get in the shelter to hunker down, and this is the first time that a question can be asked, and somebody needs to answer it. Nothing to do with the person. How it came about and who is responsible to who is an issue that I need to know and the citizen.
Yeah, Council President, I'm presenting basically the same thing. It's about the community. The community isn't aware of all the dynamics that are involved in this negotiation. They're not aware of the limitations that are involved because, in essence, there will be limitations. There will be decisions that need to be made that would be sent down from the state that won't be necessarily advantageous to the city, per se, from our purview. So when those decisions need to be made, it's going to be extremely difficult for them. There's no question of his capability. You know, we've given him his accolades before. We still speak highly about him. And I appreciate the fact that the state acknowledges that the team that's in essence in place knows what they're doing. We've showed timeless times how we are very able to do what is expected of us and have done with all ducks in a row, everything in order. So I do appreciate that. But again, it has to do with allegiances. And then when the time comes and strategies take place, you know, what do we have now? Because ultimately, as the man brings a knowledge of wealth now to the state, he also brings the knowledge of strategies that the city may have had in the past could have been advantages to the situation. The state isn't fully aware of everything until they're told. So now he's got to work for another boss. So when they inquire, he's got to tell.
You did a good job. One last thing.
Answer. Since we're talking about who's paying him, right? Since we're talking about who's paying him, is there proof that this man is still on the city's budget, or has the state taken him on? And I think it's a 30-day window that he has before he can go on to the benefit. So, because as I read in the press, the 23rd he was supposed to come on board with the state. Is he still on board with the city right now in terms of an employee of the city? And if that document isn't in place, then theoretically he still works for us until he signs off on that document stating that the state will now be paying him. I just find it very very troubling that we talk about various people fighting when we're in Trenton for a non-state takeover. You got to basically look at the spectrum and say, okay, who were we fighting with? When this gentleman now becomes an employee of the state, when he was supposedly being in Trenton, standing side by side, stating that he's fighting for the city, I'm not so sure as to how we get to a clear path in terms of how we resolve this.
What is there to resolve?
The fact that you don't understand that it's a conflict for someone to have two hats, when in fact that you're stating that the state's here, so let's just lay down. You're saying that the state is here, so just lay down. I'm saying I don't care if the state is here or not. Right is right, wrong is wrong.
Wait a minute. Here's what I'm saying. Let's not rewrite history. There's a history of what happened with regard to the supposed state takeover. There's a clear history of who said what and who did what. So we don't have to get unclear about that.
What I'm trying to understand, what correlation are you making to this particular point? Where's the correlation?
My point is that the state is here. That's reality.
We got that.
The point is that the state can have operational control according to the law. That's reality.
We got that.
The point is that we have a person here who has, the state says they have seen that he has the professionalism to carry out some of the operational issues that we have.
We have that.
And I don't see the conflict, and I'm saying very strongly that it is better for us to have Jason Holt here in an operational position than someone else here who is not as familiar as he is with city issues. He can speak for himself, but I take strong exception to the fact that there's allusion to the fact that he didn't carry out his duties in a strong way.
I think you went out at the wrong time.
I'm sorry.
I think you left at the wrong time. It ain't about his profession and what he brings. I got 100% support for what he did to try to get this thing. They don't know how this hurricane or this tornado came, and they want to know how it happened. Yes. Right. So you left out before I told you that. It was a tornado that came, and this is the first time they've had they got the opportunity to find out how it happened and why it's the reason for it. So that's not nothing to do with Jake. They need to know.
Right.
I don't know, and I don't think you know everything about it. They want to know.
Council members, I know that we're going back and forth on this important issue. You know, debates on both sides of the coin. Would the state or Mr. Holt like to make a comment?
I've made all the comments I'll make on it.
Okay.
Council President, and you to the other members of council, to the public in general, based on the statements that have already been made, I just want to clarify one thing, and I view this as an opportunity to continue to serve and assist the citizens of Atlantic City and Atlantic City government in a different capacity. I think that speaks for itself.
That's exactly what I was saying. Exactly what was. They need to hear from you what is going forward, and to not do that would have been wrong, and thank you.
All right. More the agenda.
Joe Hicks.
Thank you.
evening, Council, Mayor, good evening.
Good evening.
Y'all have to excuse my third leg, but it comes in handy at times.
It's all right.
First, I want to say to the police department and the fire department, my prayers are out for them. I know the mayor has to do what he has to do, but I hope that the fire department and police department is left intact, because crime is down, and the fire department and the police department, they're always giving back to the community. They're just as helpful as they are, but without them, we have a lot of problems. Also, when you speak on Browns Park, I think y'all are doing a beautiful job in Browns Park. What I would like to see with that Browns Park is that they always, the press is always talking about robbery and crime. Yeah, have you ever known anyone to be robbed at Browns Park or someone hurt? No one in here can ever tell me they knew of any time when anyone was hurt at Browns Park, where they talk about drugs. Yes, drugs. Something had to be done because of the drugs. But there wasn't no crime there, no outside of drugs. Nobody was hurt there. That one incident took place, and you would think that hell broke loose. But, you know, something had to be done, and you all are doing a beautiful job at Browns Park. You know what I'd like to see? The Freedom Garden. It's sitting way back where can't nobody see it. I like to see the Freedom Park put out there in this park when it's complete. It won't cost that much, and I think it would be a beautiful thing. Because when you come into Atlantic City, you can see the park. And I also think the Daniel Johnson statue should also be put over here. Thank you, and everyone have a good day.
Thank you.
Charles Goodman.
Mr. Burrow says all the time, and Mr. Shabazz, that I get a little bit too emotional, but I get emotional about my city.
Yeah.
I had a bunch of notes. I was actually going to take off from Mr. Tibbetts because it's very important. He was on point with the county tax thing. I had a bunch of notes to affect this. But this discussion up here, gentlemen, I know all of you. This ain't about friendship. This ain't about a nice guy. This ain't even about a competent guy. This is business. This is somebody switching over to the other side. That's what it is. This is it. They have laws in Congress. When you leave Congress, you can't go and be a lobbyist for 2 years. There's reasons why. Mr. Delgado, strategies. We have certain strategies that they might not be aware, that they'll know now. Okay? I mean, I just find it so unbelievable that this is allowed to happen. The other thing, are you aware that the MUA had a law firm that represented them? And where'd they even go to? With the who? With the state? Okay, so if I got all the people that know all the ins and the outs that are on your side, now bring them to my side, who controls everything? Yeah, you say they control it. Yeah, that's all paper. But I'm surprised, Mr. Shabazz, as a rebel, that you said we're not going to sit there and let that happen. Has it happened? Yes. Now, to one other point. You guys have said in the takeover of other cities. Let's make this very clear. Atlantic City, New Jersey, is the first city under the DCA that has been taken over. Let's make it very clear. All other cities, there have been memorandums of understanding, and they have pushed over the money. They tell you they only gave Camden a certain amount of money because they gave it in other sources. The DCA, when the issues, their whole proclamation was to assist, aid, and help cities that are in financial situations. I can go all the way back to Weehawken. They was about to go bankrupt. They didn't want it. What they do? Help them out. And that was for the Sea Land box company. I can go to all kinds of cities where they came in, did their job as they were supposed to do, assisted, aided, helped, and then moved on. Who did they take over? Atlantic City, New Jersey. So this is the first time that they have done that. So that's the issue. And then you're going to have somebody that's in on the end that knows every figure and knows something. Where it's been changed, where it's been allocated, and now he's on their side, I have a problem. I know Mr. Holt, he is a nice guy, very competent guy, but I have a problem when you become on the other side.
That's right.
Okay, Trump came in. Did he keep all of Obama's people? No. He got his own people. Okay? And that's what's happening with the state. They're taking from us, and I don't see how we allow it to happen. Thank you. And does he drive, still drive a city car when he goes out on things?
Mr. Goodman.
Okay, yes, thank you. I have my notes, Mr. Thibodeau, because I had to hold back up for why 13%. It should be lowered from 11.5. Instead of going up to 13.5, 11.5 should be lowered.
Mr. Goodman.
Okay.
Thank you. With you on that.
Oh, 22.77, yes.
I'm with you on that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Because we gave them $25 million last year. What did we get it for? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Time is up.
No problem here.
Sandra Robinson.
Hey, Mr. Goodman, I'm going to remember your hearing next
And Marty, I think it's only fair. His taxes just went up 13.9%. His time should go up 13.9%.
Somebody do the math on that real quick.
Address, Sandra Robinson, 225 North Virginia Avenue, apartment 1607, Shore Park High Rise.
That's right.
Good evening, Councilman President, and good evening, Councilman. Now, we're going to go back to some things. I told you I'd be back. Last year, I told you I'd be back. 2016, January the 23rd, we had a snowstorm with high tides. The water was up to my waist, and I had a car that was damage and could not be repaired. January 23rd, 2017, flooding, same thing, but this time on TV. Delaware Avenue, I could see, which is a block from me, had water up to my waist. Again. Now, I did everything I was supposed to do. I went and did everything. I've seen every administrator. I found out the reason, because I've been here too long, and I was born here, but I wasn't raised here. I'm part of New York when they went bankrupt, Lindsay, Mayor Lindsay. And I asked Shabazz, and I asked Forty, why is Atlantic City not filing bankruptcy? New York did 2 years out of it and still fine. Now, this is sad. Now, we're fighting over things that we need to take and solve. Now, here, FEMA was not a part of the play last year. For those of us who lost damages, who lost property, who lost home, I'm a senior citizen now on disability. My money, and I paid my doggone taxes with our own property. And I also take care of my business where I'm at. I'm a community activist. And there were many of us that did not get a car or no kind of compensation. Now, I would like to know, this year, I'm talking to now the administrators, because we went through all this. I went all the way through administrative, emergency management, you name it. Okay, the domes are still broken, ain't fixed yet, because you ain't got no money. Okay, but the same situation, what are you going to do for those? I'm talking to the administration, business administrator and mayor. What have you set up for those of us who never got compensated, and now this year, what are you doing? And this is important. FEMA was not a part because FEMA said the flood rescinded, and therefore there was nothing to be done for us that suffered. So what are you doing this year? And this time, I think I need a good answer. And I don't want to be sent to emergency management, planning development. And I already done talked to the mayor's office last year. And I had to tell them, I mean, come on, you got to talk real now.
Ms. Robinson, I'm going to suggest that you speak with members of the administration, possibly even the solicitor.
Solicitor, I would be glad.
As we discussed, we talked about.
And who's the business administrator?
Similar.
Oh, I don't
know.
I know you.
We talked about.
I asked you what was your taxes after things went from your apartment.
Excuse me. We talked about the situation, and we had this area. We had the same type of storm
Same date, and that's a coincidence? That's God.
If the administration would put in touch with emergency management, our emergency management team, and they will get back to you and give you an answer.
Last year, he told me the same thing much, and he was seeing FEMA, never, I wouldn't call all the numbers, never got back to me. He's had to do what he got to do, because I'm going to die.
Listen, I know you very well.
You know me now.
You ain't never hesitated to knock on my door.
You got that right, any time of night when there's a problem in my neighborhood.
Absolutely, and we'll get it done, okay?
Okay.
So, Anthony, somebody...
And that's the city civic solicitor?
Yeah.
What's his name? Oh, Anthony Swamp, can we see each other, because I need to talk. All right, sir. And Shabazz, I asked you about the bankruptcy the other weekend.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now I want to tell you this right now. What he has said, Councilman Small, Speed, what Councilman Gilliam has said, this ain't got nothing to do, this is business. People need to know the truth.
Okay, all right, Ms. Fox, since your time is up, thank you very much.
Have a good evening, Councilman President.
No problem.
Mayor. Carol Jones?
Good evening. My name is Carol Jones. I live in Tuckahoe, New Jersey, 247 Marshall Hill Road, and I'm a member of the Surf Rider Foundation. I'm here to urge you to pass the ordinance to amend the code which regulates nuisances. Longport and Margay have already passed a ban on balloon releases, and Ventnor is in the process of passing such a ban. Helium balloon releases are harmful to sea life and birds. Most of these balloons end up in the ocean, where they pose a great hazard. Sea turtles often mistake them for jellyfish, which is part of their diet. I was on a sailboat sailing to Europe several years ago, and I was halfway there and saw a big sea turtle swallow a Mylar balloon. Balloons travel great distances and take a very long time to biodegrade. Latex does not begin to degrade for 5 months, and Mylar can take up to 6 years. Dolphins and whales are also endangered by balloons. They eat squid, which tends to congregate near plastic debris. The Marine Mammal Screening Center reported that a young sperm whale washed ashore after eating a balloon at sea. The whales cannot digest the balloon, so the debris remains in their digestive system until they starve to death. Seabirds can become entangled in the ribbons that tie the balloons together. We're all fortunate to live so close to the sea and the wonderful wildlife it supports. Please take the humane step of banning balloon releases out of respect for the ocean and the creatures that live in it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jane Stark? Steve Jasicki?
Steve, just thank you from 112 North Point, thanks for having me. I want to speak on behalf of the balloon release also. Last time, I think the only time Atlantic City had a mass balloon release was when Showboat opened up. I was there, I was working on that building at the time. Thousands of balloons were released into the air, and these balloons end up in the ocean. Thousands of them. And it's, Carol was right. I'm a diver. I have a lot to do with the ocean, and it is a problem with the balloons being ingested by sea turtles, dolphins, whales, all kinds of creatures. But we have a large problem with trash going into the ocean. We're all aware of the garbage patch out in the ocean, and this is one tool that we can use to be able to curtail this. Bring awareness to the people about what we're doing to our oceans, because these plastics, these rubbers, are breaking down, getting ingested by fish, and we catch them, and we eat them. So I'd like for you to Atlantic City to join Margate, Longport, and Ventnor, and start showing the world that we are starting to take action to curtail some of the pollution that we're doing in the ocean. It's a small step we can take, but it's a big, but it's a step nonetheless.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Joseph Palillo?
Whoa.
Look out.
Oh, time out.
Hey, excuse me, before you say one word, there will be no electioneering in the council chambers. I don't want to see that political for mayor t-shirt, so button up the coat. I got good eyes, man.
I gave somebody out a little while, man. Thank you. Is there a hiring freeze in the city?
Supposed to be, yes.
Well, you have a vacancy. Why don't you reappoint or appoint a new administrator? He's the state administrator, but we don't have an administrator, right?
We have to do this.
Well, that's all right. You speak for all council. Okay. Oh, one sec. I'm going to have to put my glasses on. I'm sorry about that. Well, this is about money, right? We're here about money, right? Money. Atlantic City's money. You know, I said on radio in a number of places that Atlantic City owns 3/4 of a mile over the Brigantine Bridge. That's far land. Okay? You can check the title map. Brigantine's been collecting fees, licenses, and taxes on that land when Atlantic City should be receiving that money. And over 40 years or so, that would amount to millions of dollars. So I can help you with your debt. Another one is resorts bought the north side over the Brigantine Bridge. Have they been paying their taxes for 40 years? Maybe nobody knows, because there's a lot of things that nobody knows here. So I would suggest to the solicitor that he go after that money. Have they paid their taxes here? Access fees, license. Second, two casinos have wells that go down into the aquifer. They drain water for the casinos for about 40 years, and they don't pay for it. Okay? There's a couple more millions of dollars. That would be Bally's and Resorts. Another point. The credit is 7,700 parcels that they don't pay, and they want to get a casino thing for 2%, and the walk does 2%. I want the residents to get 2%. I don't want to pay 2% of my $2,000 every quarter on three properties. Right? You're taking all this money. I want a cut in taxes. Now, if the state's doing that,
they ought to do that.
They ought to do that for us.
One second. A senior citizen role, I don't take it, you know what I mean? About Bader Field.
Never sell it. Lease it. And reopen Bader Field as an airport. Okay? Can have one runway. Little islands in the Caribbean have an airport. And this city's got an airport 2 blocks away from the boardwalk. And Whalen was wrong turning that field off. Right? And we ought to get it back and have an airfield, because then people come in with wads of money in their pockets. All right? So there's more. Maybe I'll come back again someday.
Mr. Pillow, you have a resume?
Pardon me?
You have a resume you can leave with us?
No, but I will. I'll put it on a website or something.
No problem.
Will you state your address, please?
Pardon me? Oh, Joseph Palillo. I'm not going to give you my exact address. Chelsea Heights.
Michelle Connors? Good evening. My name is Michelle Carrera. I am the CEO of the Boys and Girls Club of Atlantic City. I'm here to talk about the amending to Chapter 98 that regulates the trams car. For the last few years, the Boys and Girls Club have been working hard to manage the economic crisis that had affected everyone in the city. Last year, this council passed an ordinance that allows 7 cents of each trans card ride to go to a nonprofit organization, and we were benefited with that additional revenue. This meeting has been quite enlightening for me, first meeting for in a council. But the truth is that we talk about our economic crisis, we talk about casino, we talk about taxes, but we have a generation that is growing in the shadows of this economic crisis. The last 5 years have hit very hard their families. We have a drug crisis that is affecting not only them as young people, but also as their parents. And the nonprofit organizations, we have been trying to make it through this economic crisis without relying that much on the support of the government, making sure that while we get back on our feet as a society economically, that we didn't leave that generation back, that we make sure that every kid in Atlantic City has the opportunity to become a successful citizen. We provide services every day from 3 to 8 p.m., 12 months of the year. We're serving 150 kids a day. Last year, we served over 1,000 kids. We provide education and career development, character and leadership, sport and recreation, art and health and life skills to make sure that they have the skills to be successful. So we are here to request that the council consider to leave that 7 cents in the amending of that ordinance so we can continue to have a revenue that allow us to prevent more kids to become a social burden to the city. Every disconnected youth costs over $30,000 a year, while we're serving them for less than $2,000 a year.
And just, I know it's not in the original, but we will be making an amendment from the floor to continue to support all children, especially those with disadvantaged circumstances, to
thank
become
you.
Productive and caring citizens. That's a little Boys and Girls Club name. So
thank you.
That's what it is.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Councilman, you said it's not in
there? Yeah, he's going to be making an amendment from the floor. We want to make sure that continues to happen because they benefited.
So who took it out originally? If it was already in there, who took it out?
Jesse, you want to answer that?
Okay. Well, I guess two things. One is learning the new process of dealing with the state. I was notified by other people today that things that were in the ordinance when we approved it in committee were not in the ordinance when they arrived today. So it's, you know, we should be reading our packets, of course, but now we've got to read the packet and we get it. We've got to read it again in committee, the version that we're working on. Then we've got to read the copy of record, if you will, so that way in terms of what we still do control and personally, we're responsible for. But to directly to your question, Councilman Gilliam, this was part of that measure that we passed, which permitted the operator to collect an optional donation of 7 cents on the single ride, and I think it was like 6 cents, or so, it was a different denomination for the day pass to make up for that. And the vendor decided to use Boys and Girls Club as their charity of choice.
I understand that. I'm asking who took it out. If it was in there, if it was already in there, and they're saying that they're coming here asking us to make sure it's in there, who took it out? And why would that be something that we would take out, knowing that it benefits the kids?
Yes.
And you're saying that you don't know who took it out?
Well, I mean, I get what you're saying.
No, I'm asking you a question. Do you know who took it out?
Well, the reason I'm qualifying is because it wasn't part of the ordinance initially, is my understanding. It was a separate resolution that authorized the collection of an optional donation. And so what I wanted to see, and that's part of why this amendment that everybody's mentioned, I'll share it with the public, but I wanted something formally in the ordinance, like you're suggesting, so that way it's not up to the discretion of a vendor or the discretion of an administration, that by statute it would be a certain percentage that goes to the Boys and Girls Club.
So in other words, if we put something in a resolution or ordinance, they must respect it because they are basically doing business with us, utilizing our boardwalk and utilizing our property. So I don't think, although I agree with you that you consummated and putting it in the ordinance form, I'm saying that there should be no organization that commits to doing something with our kids and community have to worry about, like the Boys and Girls Club have to worry about someone trying to renege on an agreement that we consummate, whether it's an ordinance or a resolution. So I applaud you for making sure that that's put in there, but I don't know who would dare try to snuff our children, because anyone or any entity that would do something like that, I'm more or less willing to say we should not be doing business with them.
Anthony Brower, Friends in Action, Atlantic City.
Hello, Council, Mayor, general audience here. Just to give you an update, last year, Friends in Action and the community, we did a resounding thing with all of our activities. To list a few, starting at the beginning of this year, we have some things that we already do. So we have our food bank that we do the first Friday every month, Stanley Home Village. Because of our outreach work and also with Councilman Delgado, and also Chief Henry White, I'm like, hey, we're doing another food bank starting sometime this year. Councilman Marsh in your ward, the fourth ward, over the second bridge of the Loon area, there'll be a food bank that'll be going over there. I'm like, hey, forthcoming. We're looking at also possibly another food bank within the first ward or the fifth ward, depending on the needs. Our events during the course of the year, many have come to kind of figure out, but just to give y'all a list. We have our Easter egg hunt annually. We started with Councilman Delgado and the Multicultural Programmers Committee, the Multicultural Festival. We have Unity Festival. We have on our agenda this year, once again, our senior citizens prom, gala, and ball. We did last year the Halloween trunk or treat with the city unlike itself. Turkey giveaway unlike hey, our toy drive. Looking at this year, because of the summer youth job situation for our kids, and possibly a rec fest with the Seal Pier. And we're looking at working on it as well as a fundraiser for our children to have employment during the summer. And what that's kind of designed to be is that an entity can take the youth to employ them, and the funding for that will give that entity for the summer, for the whole time of work for the summer. So that entity does not have to worry about how to pay for that child for the summer youth program. That's something that we're trying to definitely work on and it's kind of be pushing. We have upcoming, which I'll give the council, February 24th of this year, we have our Hometown Hero Celebration once again. Thanks to all the council and the resolutions that we've done, this will be our third event, and I have a flyer forthcoming. Sad to say, unlike one of the family members, one of our members of Friends in Action died Saturday, tragically, I'm like cancer. Was in the hospital, name is Neil Cuff Whitey. Left the hospital Saturday and died. One of the members of the community that was Friends in Action's Hometown Hero. A gentleman that came every Friday, continually, year after year, for the food bank. Was there for every single event. And nobody would have ever known him, because he was very quiet, soft-spoken. But if you asked him to do something for the community, he was. So for our Hometown Heroes, see, recognizing y'all is because of that. Y'all do it because that's the way you were meant. That's the way you're built. And that's why everybody said, give them their roses while they're here now, before they pass away. This is gotta do it for Neil. So for council, I'll give you information for our Hometown Heroes. And y'all, please select people to be a part of it. And we can honor them. I'm like, we did your wife, Marty.
That's cool.
You can submit nominations to the nominating committee so that a decision can be made. Representatives, 2 weeks prior to the event, we're trying to get the committee. Right.
What day is it?
February 24th, with six. From 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. at Dante Hall, with a hopefully a refreshment site will be located to have a reception after. Just to add, Council President, if you don't mind, I just wanted to finish up with the Hometown Heroes. Hometown Heroes is one of those things that we're very proud of, because we try to protect it to be wholesome. We try to protect it from any kind of interference of politics, anything that would be a bias. We try to make it unbiased, so it's a selective committee comprised of people from the community. There's no one side versus others, and it supports people who have efforts that are unheard. These are the quiet people who just seem to do miraculous things that most of us won't know. So we're trying to give them, as they say, we're giving them flowers while they're here. And there's so many people who do that in our city. There's amazing individuals who go out and put their necks out on the line, continuously speak endlessly for those who don't have a voice of their own, or just tirelessly put efforts like Neil, who put their manpower, their energy into every effort to help others with no need for accolades, no need for anything in return you could always depend on. Those are individuals that Hometown Heroes was created to spotlight. So if there are individuals that you know fit that task, please, first off, look at the list of people we've already honored, because we've honored, I'd say, about 40 people, 40, 50 people, including about 25 different companies who've assisted the city itself, certain schools, representatives in the school, some elected officials, some non-elected officials, and the powerhouses of some of our elders who've been around forever, doing tireless work, endless amounts of work to benefit the community. So if you do have someone that you have in mind, just let us know. Each one of us can probably represent the community, as we do. You can speak to one of us if you have someone that you'd like to nominate. Bring the information to City Hall. We'll get the information through. You can either forward it upstairs to the city clerk's office and collect just a nomination there. We just ask you that you submit a name and a short bio of the individual and why you feel that person deserves to be nominated. So that name can go forward to the committee itself, comprised of past winners and some that are just community advocates, to look and just decide who are the top 10, top 15. Hopefully we will honor everyone, because in these trying times, everyone does their part and everyone deserves a little accolade. So hopefully we have enough flowers to go around. Thank you.
Beth Clark.
Enter.
Hi, my name is Beth Court. I'm at 125 North 30 Avenue in Ventnor. I'm here representing the Surf Rider Foundation South Jersey chapter, of which I am the chair. The Surf Rider Foundation supports the ordinance that's listed as 1B, to amend Chapter 190 of the code, which regulates nuisances. It's to ban intentional balloon releases in the city. As my friends spoke previously, balloons cause a lot of issues in the marine environment. They're commonly found during beach cleanups as well. So they litter our beaches, litter our ocean. We know that Atlantic City has beautiful beaches. We want to keep them clean and encourage tourism, encourage residents to use them. So it's important to keep them clean. It's a common sense legislation. It's an easy way for you as the council to protect the ocean, and I thank you for introducing it. I also want to let you know that we had a beach cleanup at North Carolina Avenue for the Martin Luther King Day of Service. We partnered with Stockton University and Our Lady of the Star Sea School. We had 60 volunteers come out and clean the beach that morning. It was very successful. And we're also having a beach cleanup this Saturday, January 28th, from 1 to 3 p.m. In the Cove, right past Golden Nugget. So if anyone's interested in attending, I invite you all to come out and meet more of our volunteers and clean up the beach. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Monica Coffey, Margate.
Hi, good evening. Monica Coffey, 16 North Fredericksburg Avenue in Margate. I'm here representing the Atlantic City Green Team, of which I'm a member, as well as Ventnor, Margate, and Longport Green Teams. I'm also a member of those as well. And I just want to thank you for considering this ordinance, this nuisance ordinance, which would, it's not an assault on balloons, but just on their intentional release, which really is just a form of littering. Margate was the first to do this about 4 years ago. We've been working with the other coastal communities to have them enact it as well. So as Beth and the others have said, it is just a really common sense measure and a step towards decreasing the amount of plastic and trash that is in our beautiful ocean. And I hope if this gets in the media, there is a chance that the Balloon Council will make an appearance at the next meeting. And I just hope that you aren't swayed by their arguments and propaganda. So they've come out to every council meeting and they, you know, try to tell you why this is a bad idea. But it's really a common sense thing to do. If anybody's been out on the water or walked the beach, you know that there are balloons out there. So thank you for showing leadership and considering this ordinance.
Thank you.
Joyce Molyneux?
Did you sign it?
Excuse me.
For those of you who may not know the protocol, you want to sign up to speak when you walk in the council chamber, that she is always in the front. And at the end, when everybody's on the sheet, I always ask everyone would they like to speak. So I'm going to give you an opportunity now, if you want to speak, to sign your name on the sheet.
Good afternoon, Council President and Council members. I attended the Niagara County Freeholder meeting last night. And again, I requested that the county pay Atlantic City what they owe us, instead of hiring lawyers that the taxpayers are paying for in Atlantic City to fight against us. Atlantic County needs to pay us what they owe us. They owe us money, we want our money. Now, Councilman, Public Enemy number two, Councilman Shabazz. A conflict is a conflict is a conflict. However, I'm assuming you do not know what a conflict is, because you're now serving as the NAACP president and serving as council and not supporting the NAACP issue, which I'm going to pass to you regarding the NAACP's resolution on a moratorium on charter schools. Could you pass this one on to them, please?
Thank you, Ms.
Also, in this statement from the NAACP, it states that the NAACP's resolution on a moratorium on charter schools. We are calling for a moratorium on the expansion of charter schools, at least until such time as charter schools are subject to the same transparency and accountability standards as public schools. We also know, and there's three more items on there, but everyone will get one and they can read it at their leisure. Mr. Mayor, I'm gonna leave you this one. We have a president that has hired a education chair that does not support charter schools. That does not support public schools. We are requesting that all call the National, Washington National, and ask that they do not place her in that position, especially all NAACP members.
That's for the governor, too?
Oh, yeah, we know that. But that's how I got on the agenda from the governor, through Public Enemy number one. Thank you so much, everybody.
Mr. President, I don't usually respond when people say something, but just for the record, Ms. Molyneux's statement is incorrect about my support as NAAC president. I support all of the resolutions and positions of the NAACP. And I have taken the same position that the NAACP does with charter schools, for the record.
And actually, since charter schools came up, I was going to wait until announcement time, but I want to applaud the efforts of people from the city who are actively preparing a charter school. I think that charter schools offer a tremendous lifeline and just another option to children who do not necessarily possess the means to send their child to a private school, and charter schools being free tuition are a great addition to our educational options here in town. There's a amazing young group of people trying to start the Frederick Douglass School for Boys, and they have an event coming up on Saturday, February 18th at the Sheraton. It's a father-son breakfast. And anybody who's a supporter of charter schools, of giving more educational options to kids, they can come out and support this Saturday, February 18th. They're on Facebook. It's /FDSB2018. Thank you.
Indra Owens, Atlantic City.
Council President, before Ms. Indra comes up, I think my colleague may be doing a disservice to the Frederick Douglass organization.
Absolutely.
With attaching the campaign to support charter schools.
Absolutely.
The initiative is one that's very noble, very caring, specific to a need that's grand. But to attach it to a campaign for charter schools, which we know is a business aspect, I think disenfranchises opportunities for Frederick Douglass and the initiatives that people want to do so. I think that's not being discussed. You mentioned free tuition to the children that may be attending to, someone's got to pay. And ultimately, if it comes from the city's school district, then the residents pay. And the children have to suffer from that as well. But that's the business aspect. So it's not to go on with the same beleaguered discussion, but we have to be very cognizant of how we support and how our support sometimes can negatively impact those that we think we're supporting.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Indra Owens. I'm a homeowner in this area. I live in Venice Park. I'm also an educator. I work for Lansing Board of Education. An advocate for the rights of young women and our children. And I really am just wanted to mention something about Browns Park. So I'm a little annoyed as a taxpayer and as a homeowner who is extremely invested in this area, that I had come to a few council meetings before about like the loitering that's going on, and about Browns Park, me believing that the land wasn't being used appropriately. And so I had been asking the question, so who was the person who actually, who are the days who somebody had a meeting and the defense went up? I want to be actively involved in that, the planning and the development. I believe that parks are for families and kids, and something should have been happening in Browns Park. I'm excited, so I first say thank you for the efforts of whoever had something to do with now the reconstruction and the redevelopment of Browns Park. I also wanted to know, are any of this man's successors, like his family, are they involved? And how can I be involved? And so I'll wait until the end of the meeting because I'd like some contact information.
I'll tell you right now, you can talk to Director Turner. I've been fortunate enough to try to spearhead that effort. And we meet every month. In fact, we just had a meeting on Browns Park. We have an ad hoc committee of people who are giving input.
I'd love to be a part of the ad hoc committee.
You can talk to her. You can see that there's a very good design. It's already set up. And I'm very sure that you will appreciate the design because it's a universal design for children who might have handicaps or different abilities. That's part of it. It's a part for the veterans, and it's a whole part. And it's interesting you asked about Mr. Brown. I am trying. In fact, I got a call into Congressman Lobianda's office. Because we can't find any information about Harold Brown.
I don't know.
The library. But if you can help with that, we're looking for that. Thank you so much.
And so who did you say I need to talk to?
Liz Mr. Church, she's right here.
Oh, okay. Right. Thank you.
For the record, Councilman, should ask, for the last maybe year or so, I've heard you state aye. I was interested, but no timeout. When things are initiated, it is very professional and fair to share that it's just not I. It's someone else who basically was a part of spearheading that. And I would like to ask you, when you make mention to those things, that people that actually truly spearheaded, you include them in that process and not take the helm to yourself.
Councilman, as you know, at the last meeting, I recognized you and indicated your support.
But wait a minute,
I tried to be accurate. I was addressing her specific question about involvement.
I'm, I'm, I'm just saying moving forward, because I think that it's important for folks to realize that we all do things, and it's never a I, it's a we. But when it's something that I know I had my DNA all over, and hear you meeting after meeting state that it was you, I thought it'd be fitting to actually say, please include people who help.
I never said it was me. I said that I was encouraging the council to move forward in efforts, and I said that I called community meetings, which is true. And as you know, you get an invitation to every meeting. Every meeting that I call, you get an invitation to.
I don't believe that you're responding to what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, not that you include, I'm saying that you can't really include me in something that I've already helped spearhead. So I'm saying that when you say I, it gives the perception that it's only been you, when it's things that I initiated. So it would be very fair to share in those accolades. That's all.
Councilman, you're eminently correct.
Appreciate you.
You were involved before I was even here. But now going forward, you're still invited to every meeting, and we still want you to come.
John Tamanglo, Atlantic City.
I would like to clarify something.
Excuse me. You can't. Excuse me. No.
Council President, Council Members, City. Ordinance 98 for the first reading tonight again. On the first reading again tonight?
Yes.
Last time I was here, it was postponed indefinitely. Now we're starting again.
Are you talking about one D?
Yeah. So that's the trailers again, right?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Jesse Kurtz, three meetings back, said to give him a call to discuss anything with the trams or the boardwalk. I made 7 personal phone calls to him without 1 return, number one. Number two, I walk into the meeting tonight, and the ordinance that you're looking to put up for first reading tonight is lacking a 7 cents. Okay? It's my belief that this ordinance is being rushed. For what reason, I don't know. But I'm going to ask you to not have this ordinance tonight, because next Thursday, the judge is going to rule on the tram completely. He'll have his decision on next Thursday.
Mr. Tamagli,
yes.
If you can frame your discussion and not mention any potential legal issues.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, now, and this ordinance was pulled by the state, if I believe, right? Last time?
Correct. You can make your statement. Make your statement.
Yeah, the state.
They're not going to respond to you.
They're not going to respond. Okay. So is it going to be approved? Is it state approval of this tonight or not approval of it?
Everything we do, the state gets final approval of. Sure, they look at what we do and then they...
But I mean, did they approve this ordinance to come through tonight?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm going to ask if this ordinance can be pulled again for just one more session. And I would appreciate it, because I believe it's getting forced, and especially because Mr. Kurtz never invited us to a committee hearing, and especially I didn't even return 1 of 7 phone calls, which I believe is very unprofessional.
When you showed up to the meeting the other day...
I was at a meeting last Wednesday. I was thrown out. First, Mr. Randolph. Didn't you tell me, Mr. Randolph, you'll invite me in the tram?
Because I was walking in just as you were walking
yes.
in, and I didn't realize that you weren't supposed to be there, so you were told by an attorney that you could not be there.
Yeah, let me just, excuse me.
Yeah, that's okay.
Let me just say this to the council members. We're going to be very limited. You have the right to speak here, but we're going to be very limited in our responses because of the litigation that you've been involved in with regard to this.
Well, then how do you communicate?
I have to advise them in that matter.
Okay.
You called Mr. Kurtz recently. I returned your calls. I don't know if you knew that it was me who actually returned your calls.
No.
But I did return the calls.
I didn't get one.
In his stead.
I'll
talk to you after the meeting.
Okay.
Time's up.
I thank you, gentlemen.
Linda Steele, Galloway.
Yes.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
Administration. Just a couple items. Mr. Goodman spoke about the cities that the state is monitoring. And I think that anybody that knows what the state has done in those other cities, they have not improved or anything. No other city in New Jersey has lost the kind of revenue Atlantic City has lost in value. And so if DCA accepted your five-year plan and the governor decided that he did not want to accept it, I think after monitoring Atlantic City for 7 years, they should have a plan. And I think that that would be fair and justified if the state claims that they know better how to run Atlantic City than Atlantic City does. I can tell you that I'm not happy about Mr. Holt being with the state now, but I would say to you that I think that we all need to be prayerful and hope that his relationship with Atlantic City has given him enough inside information and enough feeling for what is going on in Atlantic City. Because in so many other instances where there are boards in Atlantic City and Atlantic City people are not a part of, the mayor sits on the Freedom Board. He's like a lone, you know, he doesn't have a whole lot of support. And so we're going to hope and pray that his relationship with Atlantic City will be a positive for us rather than having the state bring somebody in that has no relationship to Atlantic City and doesn't give a tinker's damn about us. The other thing is that I just think that Mr. Cunningham, this is a difficult time, and it is a difficult time for everybody. And I think that for the length of time that the state has been in here monitoring, it makes me feel like you all are like the television advertisement that says, oh, I'm just a monitor, I'm not here to fix anything. That's how I feel about what the state has done, because they have not, I don't think that you know any more about how to regulate and reposition Atlantic City in from $20 billion assessment down to less than seven than anybody else does. And unless we come together and the state stops bullying Atlantic City and taking everything, because at the end of the day, the state has been the driver of this casino bus, this casino experiment. They wrote the regulations, they govern how this stuff is going. All we did was collect revenue from properties. And now we can't even run anything that is of our city. So I'm asking you to relay to whoever, to the governor and whomever else, that Atlantic City has still a lot to offer. We are not a Camden. We still have much that we can do. We have many resources. S-11 was taken over, brought on the tourist district, and nobody has done anything with it. How long has it been? 5 years?
The five casinos closed.
Well, you know what? That's not our fault.
I understand.
But I just want everybody to understand, and particularly you, Mr. Cunningham, because this is a very emotional situation. And when people come into your home and don't know about you, they're subject to think a whole lot of different things. But Atlantic City is a small community. We have so many resources, and we're just hamstrung. We have learned a lesson, and I think that everybody will agree on that.
My comment was, since the takeover of the tourism district, five casinos have closed, which means it was a dismal failure to do that in the first place. But we still have a commander of the tourism district and five casinos closed. Why?
Well, this is, I don't know.
Hey, Gary?
Wait, take change.
Council, my name is Ted Gary, owner of the Atlantic City Boardwalk Rolling Chairs. I own and operate 50 rolling chairs here in Atlantic City. I've been a part of the rolling chairs now for 28 years. I've been out here a long time. So I see that we have a tram car ordinance being presented here tonight. And I've also called Councilman Kurtz several times. I have not received any call back. there is the tram cars and the rolling chairs on the boardwalk. I would like to be part of the committee that is going to decide what goes on this ordinance. I believe that one business is given an advantage over the other. The old tram car ordinance, Chapter 98, made it so the rolling chairs could operate. I mean, the tram cars stopped at the street ends. They didn't pull up to the casinos like the tram cars are right now. I have several pictures, okay, to show what this tram car is doing. It's not fair. I mean, Mayor, you even said when this tram car came out that the rolling chairs weren't going to like it. So, and I don't like it. And the operators don't like it either. So I would like the opportunity to voice my opinion on these changes that are being made. So if I could please have that opportunity, I'd like that. Just to say it again, I did try to call you, Councilman Kurtz, and my name is Ted Carey, owner of the Atlantic City Boardwalk Rolling Chairs. I did not receive a call back. So I heard you talk about having a committee, and I would like to be involved in that. So before any decisions made, I'm sure that the state's going to have their input on what's going to go on with this tram car. So if you could please include me, I'll call you again, leave my number again. City Solicitor, did you get that message? Did you try to call me back? Because I tried to call him. I mean, you don't have to answer. I understand that you can't. But anyway, please consider that, and please pull this ordinance tonight. I'd also like to say that I am a supporter of the Boys and Girls Club. I donated my time during Storm Sandy and had applied all the drywall that's in the facility at this time, the one that's behind Proud Mary right there. So I believe that that's a good charity. Just like to say that it has nothing to do with that.
Tim Bolin.
Good evening, council members. My name is Tim Bolin from B&B Parking, and we operate the trams on the boardwalk. I also had not been contacted by Mr. Kurtz, and we were not a part of any committee as the operator of that. So if there is going to be some sort of committee, I guess I would like to be involved as well. Otherwise, I think that the ordinance that you guys have written is going to be more beneficial to the rolling chairs. The price increase from $2 to $3 or $4 is going to make it more likely that a customer is going to get into a rolling chair. Because it becomes more economical. And the other thing I wanted to mention was that with respect to the Boys and Girls Club, we never were looking to skirt them on the ordinance. In fact, I had notified Michelle of the changes that were going on so she could be here to make her case to keep that piece of the pie. Thank you for your time.
Public portion closed. Let's move the agenda.
Council, before you move that, just two things I can bring to the administration's attention. I just want to make a public comment. You got a call today on two houses on North Carolina Avenue. If you're facing the ocean, two houses off of Pacific Avenue, one of them is ready to fall down. The front porch, I don't know if you're familiar with it, those last two houses. One, the front porch is all bricked, and it's actually ready to collapse, the front porch itself.
A few weeks back, in fact, tomorrow, the construction official and code department is going there with the police to clean the place out and send the demo list.
Okay. And the other thing is for the administration, drainage issues throughout town. I've noticed in the last year, more and more so, that you have major puddles throughout town in the streets. You know, there's one on Pacific, on Albany Avenue that cuts down a whole lane for over 24 hours. And I looked there today, and there was drainage. And what I did in the past year was, during the heavy rains, I ride down Pacific Avenue, and I look for these particular spots. And one thing I did was, I look to see if it's high tide or not, and then I go down to the boardwalk to see if it's high tide, is that keeping the water up? Or if it's low tide, in most cases, that when I did check, we're in heavy storms, it's been low tide and the outfall pipes are completely empty. So I don't know if we're having an issue with drainage issues, but if you look at Pacific Avenue, it's the worst that I've seen it in my entire adult life as far as drainage issues go. I don't see an engineer here to ask the question tonight. But yesterday I called the fire department because, hey, people pulling in out of the Bader Field on Porter Avenue and Albany Avenue, going to the skate zone, and also our fire trucks. We can't afford to have our fire trucks getting ruined from going through 12 inches of water right there. And Public Works went out today and tried to clean out what they could. I understand it's a state road, but if there's a drain right there, we can't wait for the state to clean it up. We got to get that thing and keep it clean. If it's something that we have to do every storm, because I want the fire trucks, if they could, to pump it out, but they need 12 inches of water to do it. But if we could get on that, because even though it's a state road, it's our people that are affected by it. It's our safety when people come over that bridge, and then all of a sudden they got to slow down real quick because they're, you know, some type of street dividers out there. So if we could stay on top of that, Mayor, and make sure that we check into it. Or do you have any answers as to, are we having any problems since we redid the beaches, the pumping of the sand, that are causing these drainage issues that we never had, that you know of?
I have the engineer.
Can we look at the other parts of the city as well? Because I thought we did some major work.
Well, I'm just saying that's where I noticed. I didn't know if the outfall pipes are affected by the pumping of the sand, because I've never seen this in a lot of spots.
Yeah, I mean, just the other day, it was like 3/5 of the city was on the entire water. It was like 4 or 5 feet of water.
At low tide.
At low tide, exactly. So that's something that's critical. Maybe we need to engage with the state, because if the state's depending on the casino industry to be a bailout mechanism, we have to make sure that the roads and everyone else, everything else that feeds the casino industry is clear. And the tourism district includes Maryland Avenue, which is flooded, and Martin Luther King, which is flooded, and also Route 30s and 40s, which are flooded. So these are critical things that we need to address. Maybe we can partner with the county, because the county doesn't seem to be too aggressive on making sure that Route 30 is taken care of, because the water is extremely hot.
Maybe you can talk to the commander.
I heard, what's his name?
Maybe you can talk to commander.
We've never seen him.
He can help with the flood.
Right, we've never seen him much. I mean, I've seen him one time when he went to see my kids play soccer. But we don't get to see Commander Gilbert. But it would be nice to see what we can do to address this, because it has to do with safety. Ultimately, it has to do with safety.
He shouldn't be that busy because five casinos closed, so he should be able to help get that done.
Right. Maybe a water pump or something like that, like I said. But ultimately, all jokes aside, I think...
There's no joke.
No.
He get paid $100-something thousand.
Oh, exactly. Now we just got an additional $100,000 now that we don't have to pay Jason, so that money can go and assist in this situation as well. As I'm looking at it, there's the opportunities of making less waterfront property to properties that weren't meant to be waterfront properties. I mean, you got certain areas that were damaged. I mean, you got people still suffering from Sandy.
Yes.
Still have not been made whole.
Yes.
And we have the audacity to worry about things that are minuscule in comparison to people's lives. So without going off on that, because I'm about to get emotional, maybe we need to look at that, because that's extremely important, being that we're on a barrier island, being that we've already had the Jacques Cousteau industry come in, the institute, and speak to the city in Chelsea Heights to talk about water issues and how within 20 years, 90% of Atlantic City will be underwater. If we know this, since projected CRDA themselves have done independent studies, we know that they've done studies. So why aren't we dealing with that issue? I remember calling our Levinson ourselves about raising our Route 30 and Route 40 because of the rising water damage, the water, rising water. Well, at that time, it didn't seem important. Well, Sandy came in, smacked us all in the head. Now, every time we have high water, every time a nor'easter comes around, we're threatened with more and more water damage. So that's a reality. God forbid a hurricane or something else that comes in that can bring it at a time that it was an incredible thing how Sandy came about, but it's not going to be exclusive. It's not going to be something that won't come back. And what will happen when it does? So we need to focus on doing better with water mitigation. We're not going to have anyone being able to live in an area where water festers, where we have mold growing, children growing asthma, seniors and asthmatic issues. It's a health concern. The water damage that goes on, we have ideas that we have instances where other areas are having sinkholes. Water finds its way down into the ground, the substructure of the island, and all of a sudden we fall apart. Then what? We're going to sit up there and talk about balloons? Respectfully. And this is just an example I just made. And it's not discrediting them either, because it's very important. The environment is something that we can't ignore. We cannot ignore. And our environment is encroaching on us. So we have to be serious about this.
So is your balloons comment synonymous to Alan Iverson to be talking about practice, man?
Council President. Okay. Kind of lost me on that one, Council President, but okay.
Okay.
Council President, I would like to say something. Just like Council Mo Gagalo mentioned that many houses was damaged during the hurricane season. I've been getting a lot of complaints that contractors basically taking money from people and not doing the work.
Right.
And what can we do to prevent that and help the people are in our city? And I'd like to ask that question to the mayor. Maybe Director Finch, would you come up with something that you help us with people?
Special commission with investigating.
That falls under DCA.
What the city can do instead of, you know, we cannot be standing by and people stay out of their house for more than 2 years. That's ridiculous.
All right. Yes.
Okay. Is there anything?
Yeah, one of the things you can do, consumer fraud is a criminal offense. You can file a complaint with the police department, have an investigation.
Is it any way that we can create, just like we do other lists, a list of vendors that the city can more or less vouch for in terms of giving good service? Because I know like places like Margate, things of that nature, for example, we have lawn care, right? So they have a list of lawn care companies that residents can utilize. Because that is really a misfortunate thing, because most of those folks that got robbed are senior citizens.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And if in some way, and I don't know how we can do that, and maybe.
What we can do, I would request that anybody that has a problem with a contractor, contact the construction official. There are a couple of home raising companies that are really not doing a good job. They're under investigation right now. So if they have a problem, contact the construction official, and then we can take it to a step to report it to the DCA and other officials. So let us know who those people are and how to contact us.
Okay.
And to your other question, Council, the city can't engage in any endorsements, so they wouldn't be able to operate something like a Better Business Bureau or one of those types of things. They can't say who's a good contractor to use or something like that.
We could do that with our vendors.
Well, in terms of telling people who...
Not telling people, just saying that this is a group that has basically been identified by the city of Atlantic City that has done a good job, and here's a list. Not that you have to, but having a list available for the people who may be looking for some help, because for a senior citizen that may not know anything about construction, they are really looking for a hand up in terms of information, but not saying that they have to or that the city's endorsing. This is just a group of entities that we've had good responses and reports with and things that they.
My suspicions that might be a problem, because it's tantamount to, someone might take that as tantamount to an endorsement and the fact that the city.
My question, do we put together an alternative list? We have a
candidate. Right. Should do a complaint list.
Right.
Or they can investigate their contractor. Right?
Yeah.
Or alternative facts.
Alternative facts.
Yeah.
That's a Republican
statement. Councilman Chan, state of New Jersey has indicted several contractors throughout the state just recently for committing fraud and not fulfilling their obligations from Hurricane Sandy. So if you get me the names of the residents that they've been victimized, and I'll make sure that the proper entities hold that.
Okay.
I will do that. Especially, every day I'm getting more and more complaints. It's just outrageous. I'll get those names and have them contact you.
Council President, it's extremely disheartening that to this date we're still speaking about the impacts of Sandy. And I know it's shocking to have heard so many stories of construction companies and redevelopers that come in and take this opportunity for people in such high distress to economically advantage themselves, take over and make a fast buck off of someone else's pains and sufferings. But I'd like to also add that there's a large community of renters who've been impacted by this as well, subsequently. Because we do enforcement to the property owners, but the property owners don't necessarily have as much ownership to the impacts of the people they rent to, and they've been impacted. I mean, it's really saddening how I ran into a couple families that were sleeping on the floor. They had no beds. You know, thank God we had people like the Red Cross, Jewish Family Services came in. We had a lot of agencies that came in with helping hands, local churches that came in with local and doctors coming from New York and what have you with different truckloads of things to help out. But we have an immigrant population that are here to work in the community that we have, which is a service industry, that some may not speak English. They're legally here. But because there have been so much animosity, so much hatred based on immigration. And this has been going on prior to when 45 was just inaugurated. Prior to, there's been issues. And there's a large population that have had to basically beg and stay in hidden apartments here and there, in homes and buildings that aren't legal. 15, 20 built apartments in two-bedroom condominium, per se. And because we've had so much situation, they've had to really suffer. A lot of struggling. I mean, this is not to bring shame on anyone other than all of us. So we need to make sure that we're accountable to everyone. You know, because ultimately, this is a nation of immigrants. We are a nation that we all had dreams and hopes. And safety is one of the things that we should be provided from the Constitution. You know, we all raised our hands to uphold the law, uphold our Constitution, and federal. One of the things had to do with the pursuit of happiness. I've yet to see people struggle and be happy with the conditions they've had to go through. So we have to do better. We've got to be adamant to getting these lives back whole, getting the homeowners what they need, resources and what have you. We understand that the state of New Jersey at times stumbled in their process on how to help. And having to come back again to address some of those issues that having to do with REM grant process. Myself and quite a few people were at Stockton adamant, angry. I was pissed off how that process took place and where it was, because it didn't come in the community where it was most impacted. It was at Stockton. But that was then. Right now, we're still in a bad disposition because Sandy is still here. The remnants here, we're still scarred. We have a lot of people that still have to suffer through the conditions that are left from Sandy. And I think we need to do better by that. We really do. So if we develop this registry of homes or businesses that have a good relationship with the city, we need to also identify apartment buildings or people who have apartment homes that have also a good relationship with the city, met regulations. Maybe we can give them just a pat in the back so we can identify those areas that aren't being identified legally, that are not caring about these lives. Maybe that's something that we can do. I don't know if it's a legal barrier, but I just had to mention it. There's people that have been forgotten.
All right, let's move the agenda. And may I have a motion to group ordinances on first reading, regular resolutions, and new business bring on the dot?
So moved. I double second.
Moved by Shabazz, second by Marsh. We'll start. Gary, anything?
Not that.
Chang.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You said 1B, 27, 62, and 35?
Yeah.
Chang.
I would like to first answer the 1B, that's it.
I want to postpone ordinance 1, Charlie, 1C. Pull off 34 from revenue and finance. And that is all.
Council President, for 35, I'm not going to pull that off. I just want people to know that you, one of those cars used to be a council car, and then someone just left a turkey in it, and it smells like a dead body in it. So nobody up here on city council gets blamed for that. Just so you guys know that.
We auctioned off our car, man. What happened?
It's an old one. It's an old city car. One of them's a council car, and there was turkey left in it for over 4 days, and it smelled like a dead body in it. So nobody up here gets blamed for it. All our cars, somebody else has, and they all take home cars, just about. So.
No, I say Marsh.
So you don't have to pull it.
Yes, you know, Councilman could add.
Administration and governmental affairs, number 27, I abstain.
Yes.
Marsh.
Delgado.
Bill 27. Good for me.
Today we'll be voting on first reading ordinances 1A, which is amended, 1B, resolutions 28, 29, 11, 12, 24, 32, 33, 35, 36, 37, 38, 40, 51, 52, 26, 31, 41, 44, 45, 46, 42, 53, 61, and the exceptions, co-sponsor 1D, Councilman Chang, no vote, Councilman Delgado on 27, abstain for Councilman Randolph, 27. Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randolph?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Pivot?
Yes.
And Small?
Yes, and make 62 all council.
Bad. You did say that all those grants are 100% covered. And there's no match.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So our first ordinance, which we'll pull for discussion, is 1D.
You have a motion?
Move it.
Move by Gilliam, second by Tibbet. Discussion.
Let's go to the audience first. Or?
No, it's the first reading. Oh,
okay.
Second.
What are the significant changes to this particular ordinance?
Nobody to address those?
No, I need to hear from him.
Oh, okay. All right.
Because, as I mentioned earlier, this change from when it was at our committee, I actually want to defer either to the director or somebody from the state who made additional changes since our committee so they can speak authoritatively on it.
Again, I am not certain as to how we give our authority over to administration. So if you're not aware of something that has occurred for us to be voting on, it will be respectful that we pull it, because we're depending on you, not on them to tell us, because you chair the agenda. So our trust comes in hearing what you are comfortable with, opposed to what they're telling us that they're comfortable with. So, again, is there any significant changes to this that we should know of, that you are or aren't aware of? Because if you're not aware of it, then you should not be asking your council party to participate in something that's not fully 100% aware of.
Well, I'd like, just as, you know, you're asking me how I feel about it, I have no problem with that. I would like, again, because I wasn't notified directly from the time of our committee meeting to tonight, I had to come across it by rereading the ordinance. I'd like to get the parties from the administration and the state on record with what they changed from the ordinance. Because as you can see, it says on here, revised January 25th, 2017, which is today. And for the record, I would like to have the parties who revised it put that on the record. And then we can continue the conversation. That's no problem.
Do you have a bench? Come on.
Hey, the major changes in this ordinance are the fare increases. We propose that there's a peak season and a non-peak season. The peak season is June 1st through the end of September. That's $4 and $8. The non-peak season from October through May, in May, is $3 and $6. We add in a child's fare. So those under 12 is a $2 and a $5 year-round. So that was added into the ordinance. The fares include all appropriate taxes. The first part of last year, the state came in and did an audit of the tram operation and determined that they're responsible for the luxury tax of 9%. And that was something that was unavoidable. We asked last year to have a resolution adopted to enable the tax issue to be included in addition to the fare.
Not like getting that anyway.
Also, at that time, it was requested that the since the tax was 9% on $2 was 18 cents, we asked to let it be 25 cents, and the balance of that 7 cents be given to the Boys and Girls Club donation. And the tram operator did that last year, and I think that it's almost $20,000 was given to the Boys and Girls Club because of that. Now, moving forward, we included the tax to be included in the fares. And at the committee meeting, it was discussed that to keep the Boys and Girls Club donations moving, that we would add a percent of the advertising on the trams to the Boys and Girls Club. Mm-hmm. That's another area that the current ordinance does not include the availability of advertising. This one enables the operator to advertise on the trams. So that's the basic changes. The state, we've had numerous discussions with them on the tram. They reviewed it. We had conference calls, Mr. Perugini and myself and Mr. Swan and Mr. Holt. So we've been working with them on this. The only major change today was that the percent of the advertising, it was felt that by having that part of the bid process that we would get more revenues. It was proposed that 50% of the advertising go to the city and 50% to the vendor. But the state felt that to leave that blank and let them fill that in to be a more competitive bid to be received. So that's the summary of the tram operation. It was not the intent to not donate or have donations available to the Boys and Girls Club. Plus at our committee meeting, in fact, it was a major discussion we had to include that in that,
right,
because we want to keep that going for the city. So no one was deleting anything from anyone. We just wanted to include the tax in the fare to eliminate the other donation process. So,
and just for the record, directing, we're going to wrap up that portion of the discussion.
Yes.
We were advised legally that we can't put it in the ordinance. However, subsequently, upon passage, we'll add it on as a new business item for the Boys and Girls Club.
I just want to ask Director Finch, increasing the fee from $4 to $8, do the city get any of that? If not, well, we would increase the minimum of the bid.
It's an open competitive bid. The highest bidder gets the operation. So whoever gives the city more money, then that's who will get the tram operation, right, if they're qualified bidder.
Well, they said we increased the fee from $4 to $8. Now you're talking about
It's $4 for a single fare and $8 for a full day fare. It's not from 4 to 8, so if they want to ride all day, it's $8. That's up from $5.
It's still an increase in the fee, right?
Oh, yeah.
Let's just say we got a bid for $100,000 last year, and if the guy decides to bid $110,000 this year, we're only getting $10 difference.
The bids will determine that. We'll get the bids, we'll review the bids. If we feel they're not worth it, then we'll reject the bids.
Well, we can start out with a minimum bid of one, because we know that there was 275,000 rides in 2 months last year, so we took that right, 275,000.
That was 300,000 for the whole year.
For the whole year, okay.
Yeah.
But 2 months, there was 275, according to the reports that we had, which is 2 months.
No, not ridership, no.
Okay. So we can look at those numbers, come up a little bit. Marty, did you say that we're not voting on this tonight because of legal, or?
No, I said no. Maybe misunderstood.
Okay, yeah.
The portion where we talk about the funding for the Boys and Girls Club.
Okay, gotcha.
We can't put it in the ordinance, but we can vote on the business resolution.
All right. Well, first of all, Councilman, I don't have no questions for you, Mr. Finch. Councilman Kurtz, we spoke at this meeting, and I was waiting for a call myself, and you told me you would let me know and get in touch with me when I spoke to you about possibly doing the franchises, where we could create opportunity for up to 12 people to buy franchises, where individuals would own these trams, where we can get possibly $25,000 for a franchise, charge a yearly number, and create an opportunity for 12 different people to earn a living. Instead of one person, we were going to look at the numbers. He didn't do that. What concerned me was that Mr. Tarver said certain people cannot speak about certain things because there is litigation involved. And I respect that, Mr. Tarver, you're absolutely right. But why are we putting this on if I'm hearing tonight two parties and then the third party came in and said they didn't talk about it? So none of the parties involved and all the parties that wanted something to do involved with this, none of them had a chance to speak, and some of them were asked to leave because of legal reasons. Why are we going through this tonight if all those involved that wanted an opportunity to be involved were not allowed to? And if we know there's a court case next week, do we not wait one meeting and then let everybody have an opportunity to hear their concerns? I don't see the rush on doing this. And, you know, as far as advertising goes, we own the boardwalk. 25 million visitors a year there, not counting the local people that come there. So we can put in that bid, we get 100% of the advertising. If you don't like it, don't run the tram course. Somebody will. It's very profitable, which is a very huge profit we found out up there. We should take 100% of the profit. And as far as the money that goes to the Boys and Girls Club, I don't think that money, that the 10% of the advertising, if it goes that way, should go to any one entity. The money should come to the city, and we should look at PAL, you got the Boys and Girls Club, and you got the drill teams, you have everything. Because let's face it, the Boys and Girls Club have the Mr. Cats of the world and everything. So that money should be spread where we all feel and we know the need is the most throughout the city. So I mean, not just one entity. I say all those entities through the city, however, council, mayor, whoever, should get an even portion of that money if we're going to do something like that. We can't single one nonprofit out when there's a need throughout the city, especially once you cut rec, some rec things that go, and a lot of these places serve meals and stuff. So I feel that money should go into a pot that the city, whether council and the mayor together decide on who gets what, but not just one entity. It needs to go for nonprofit after-school programs or some type of sports programs in the city, because they're all in need because funds have been cut from everybody. Mm-hmm. But again, the advertising, I understand, we're in the advertising business now. We have our partnership with the signs on the boardwalk. We don't want to create competition up there with people for the same advertising dollars. We own the boardwalk. You know, if you don't like it, don't use the tram course. Part of the bid can clearly say, we are going to advertise on your thing if you want to operate your trams. If they don't like it, go pound sand. Somebody else will do it. That's our boardwalk. 25 million people. Everybody makes money off of us. You got three, we did rolling chairs and we do licenses. You got three owners of over 500 rolling chairs. That wasn't the intent. But it came down to, you got cab people. You got a handful of cab people that own every medallion. You know, we don't need to be creating now a monopoly. We need to be breaking monopolies up. I really think we need to consider, let's put our heads together, all of us. We could do it, all nine of us out here in a public meeting. Let's look at the idea of possibly creating 12 franchises to start and see if the people can make money. I started doing the numbers where it's $21,000 to $25,000 to buy the tram. You know, if we charge X amount for that franchise per year, initial buy-in thing. So, I mean, I say you pull it because you don't know what you even put up today. And because things, they changed it on you with your own admission. Number two, the people that wanted to be involved in it couldn't be involved because there's a court case going on and we couldn't speak for legal reasons. So I don't see the harm in pulling at one meeting and all of us getting together and possibly working out a thing where we could create opportunity for to be an Atlantic City resident to buy that franchise. And when you look at the fare increases, we're not letting the jitneys go up to $4 a ride. You're not letting the buses. New Jersey Transit isn't going up to $4 a ride and $8 all day. I mean, I think it's a huge increase. It's a huge increase in the, with 25,000 people, on 25 million people on that boardwalk. So I say you pull it and you put everybody in the room together and try and work this thing out, and at least experiment, explore the option of creating 12 franchises for Atlantic City residents.
And I'd like to actually clarify, Mr. Tarver, for a moment. I'd like to clarify one of your first comments. You stated that you were going to present a plan along the franchise, and the other councilman is my witness at the last committee. I actually remarked,
you know what? Excuse
me, sir. Excuse me, sir. Here's the thing. I remarked to the councilman that we were still waiting for your plan. You've complained every time that something has come out of committee that you don't like the way this is done, you don't like the way that is done, and I've yet to get one sentence in terms of an actual contribution towards working on this ordinance. And that's just fact.
A lot of these problems come in because we have given the administration too much power over the decisions. The last time we basically brought this ordinance up, it gives the discretion to one person, which is the director. And in order for us to actually have some real say in the process, this won't happen if you have to include the committee in the process. We got to the meeting and you're bamboozled because you don't know what they put on, and we're trying to actually defend something that we don't know what they're telling us. So I think that if we could, we could amend that ordinance that states that the sole discretion comes from Director Finch, that some kind of language, Mr. Tarver, you put in there that council has to be included in that final decision. Because it's not fair for us to have any department head change something without actually having the right to reach out to one of us and then get us in front of the dais right now and say vote on some changes that no one's aware of.
We can reconstruct it in the way that you'd like with regard to the resolution in terms of you know, how that's done. I have no problem working with you to try to get that done. If I can just clarify one thing with regard to Councilman Kurtz, because I think it's important. Councilman Tibbetts, I didn't tell him to leave. What I told him was that we can't speak anymore.
Exactly.
Yes. That's clear because I don't have the ability, you know, I don't have that responsibility. But with regard to Councilman Kurtz, I think it needs to be made clear, anyone saying that he didn't speak or he didn't get back. The reason why Mr. Kurtz has not been getting back is because we're involved in active litigation. same parties who have approached it in many cases have attempted to use the statements of counsel in their court cases. They produce recordings and they try to bait individuals into speaking about these things. So I'm very careful about how I allow individuals to speak to these persons, either in person or from the dais, for the protection of
counsel. Let me just ask you a question for the record. You said recordings for...
There have been previous court cases, and there are recordings that they have submitted with regard to conversations that they've had. And I think it's...
Council members?
Well, I'm going to get to just ask the parties.
Recordings?
It's very important that you understand, that we all understand, that the public understand, that there are reasons why we have tried to keep the open dialogue as to open cases that are being litigated. And this is an open case that's being litigated. So I just want to make that very clear why I have...
You make a very valid point, yes. You make a very valid point.
You want to provide the advice, Mr. Tardy, what I wanted to do with the amendment.
No, the amendment goes in the resolution.
Mr. Tardy, you make a very valid point. When things of this nature have court-oriented things in and around it, it probably would behoove us not to even put it on, to have any discussion or vote on something, knowing that there's litigation around it.
Well, the problem is there's always litigation around it.
We should have no council meeting, that's the case.
Huh?
We should have no council meeting, that's the case.
What I'm suggesting is that you may want to...
Well, certain topics already, as you just stated, that certain topics and certain people have pretty much taped things and so on and so forth. It just exposes us a lot more by putting it on.
What I would suggest is that if you tend to have extensive discussions about matters that are involved in litigation, that you do so in executive session, and it can be done that way, rather than to be having those discussions outwardly.
Frank, all I'm saying is, you know, everybody's litigating, so we should just have our name tags and just, you know, say we're here and then we, you know how this thing is going to turn out, and it might even be postponed next week. Do we wait again 3 more weeks? We don't know. So, you know, we have to. And you can agree we have to make decisions on something. So. And then we have to postpone some things.
Let's call it.
Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
No.
Gilliam?
No.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
No.
Small?
Yes.
We now have resolution 34, which is pulled from revenue and finance.
Which may I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
I want the motion. Wrong man, you know what I mean?
Who moved it?
Who
moved that?
Kurtz moved. Kurtz second by Marsh.
I thought Gilliam moved. Frank, did you move it?
Yes, sir.
I thought so. Except for the flat council, Gilliam moved it. And Marsh
second. Any questions? Any questions? Call the vote.
Okay.
34.
Yes. Delgado?
Yes.
Gilliam?
Kurtz?
No.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
Small.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was really nothing. Just right.
Seven in the affirmative, right. One in the negative. We have resolution 27 from administration, pulled by Councilman Gilliam.
May I have a motion?
Move it.
Move the motion.
Move by Shabazz. Second.
Can we bring it right back? Second. Went to the bathroom.
Second. Second by Marsh. Call the vote.
Please, we didn't say that. We need to take discussion then.
Oh, I mean, you might have discussion.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll have to read until he gets back.
Are you going to fill
us for this?
Go ahead.
Gary Hill, the municipal
You want to sing while we entertain?
Me and Jesse can dance.
I wouldn't want to see that.
We dance better than the Trumps.
No, she called 27. Call the vote then.
No, I said, can I talk?
Go ahead, yes, yes you can.
I think 27, this is a job to pay $6,000, there was health benefits involved in it. There's plenty of people that should be given a term, this is two terms he's already gotten. There's people in the third ward and any other wards that deserve a chance to serve on this board and get an opportunity to help with their taxes as well. I think it's time we make changes, I think it's time we get other people involved in the system. He's part of what, 8, 10 boards already? I think, you know, there's other people that are interested. As a matter of fact, I got a call from Mr. Padula today that said he would serve on this board for no money and no health benefits. And Mr. Chiesa said he does not get involved in any appointments unless there's money involved in it. Well, there's over $30,000 in health benefits in the $6,000 thing. We have three alternates right now sitting on the board at the MUA that only show up if somebody is absent. There's no reason that one of those alternates that only get paid $6,000 and no health benefits can't fill in this position. Not to mention, Councilman Smalls, we have disagreed on what to do with the water company, but this council has got to come together very soon, and whether it's public, all nine of us, or through committee or whatever, we have to come up with something that we all can agree on with the water company, because if we don't, come July, somebody's going to do it for us. And it's beginning of the year, so I don't think we should be putting anybody on these boards, and especially when we have three alternates sitting on that board that only make $6,000 and don't get the health benefits.
Well,
you save $30,000 by using one of those alternates on the board, or picking some senior citizen in the community that actually needs it.
Let me just correct, you know, a little bit. The alternates attend a meeting no matter what. They just don't vote unless they can deliberate. Exactly. It's just like being an alternate juror.
That's in the best way to be called in the game.
Yeah, so they do that. As far as the picks, I'm sure, you know, throughout, you know, the years, many of us could, you know, question picks, but I've always yielded to, you know, the person at ward. Councilman Shabazz feels particularly strong about his pick. You know, it's his right as the third ward councilman to, you know, choose who he wants to choose, and he indicated to me that he wanted to move forward with that. So,
Council President, also, there's 9 council members. There's 6 wards. There's 5 members. Whoever said it was first, second, third pick, it was a collective pick. There's 9 people. At bare minimum, you have 6 wards up there. It's not just the third wards, the first wards, the second. Those guys have been traditionally from a certain ward, and then when their terms are up, we give somebody else an opportunity at that. And then if one council person from the second ward got a pick last time and the 6th ward didn't, you showed professional courtesy and you gave the guy that didn't get a pick. I've been up here 12 years, never got a single pick or to put anybody up there. I don't need one today. So
it's the first time I ever heard you even comment on anybody.
Oh, no, I did it at the last pick, and then that person
had grandchildren who old up there. He's still getting appointed every time. I don't disagree with you, but submit as many names you want. Up or down.
Can I get a pick once in a while? Mark Padula wanted to do that?
For free.
That's an interesting name.
Councilman Small.
At large
doesn't get a pick?
I'm going to yield to the third ward council person.
No, I'm not saying for this particular, I'm saying how do we create a mechanism that everyone gets an opportunity to help someone out in their community? Because I've been on for 8 years. I have yet to be either considered for a pick because it's been this, and this, we got to stop this. It's been this ward against at large. We are all one unit, so it's not a war against, okay, we're wardmen and you're at large. It should be, everyone should have an opportunity to get a chance to appoint someone. And it's only fair, but for the last 8 years, we've been within this concept of it's ward, it's our turn, it's my turn. But if it turns, then everyone should be saying that they had a turn.
But Councilman, let me say this with all due respect to your assertions.
I think it's ironic that we're going to try to take a stand against Mr. Hill. Mr. Hill served.
No, I'm not taking a stand against anyone. I'm saying the process now. I'm not even.
Well, I'm not disagreeing with you. But I'm saying the process is already in effect.
So would you respectfully actually speak to what I'm saying instead of dispersing something that I'm not. I'm not talking about Mr. Hill. I'm saying the process should be put in play that everyone has a chance.
And I'm not disagreeing with you. But Mr. Hill's appointment is up, and the process has been that it is depicted of that I have, and I'm trying to exercise that. Now, you're not wrong, but we have at the beginning of the year, the council president sent out a list of appointments that was up and who was up on each board. So the conversation we're having now should have been had before.
It's been a conversation that's been had for 8 years. So well, if nothing's moved on it, so, and don't speak to me as if though I'm mute or anything. I'm sitting here telling you,
okay, I hear you
loud and clear.
And we discussed it about the last tick as well. At the end of the day, it's a $30,000 savings to the people. We are the people. We own the water company. It's $30,000 minimum. If you take the guy that wants to do it for free, it's a $36,000 savings.
And we're talking about people who've been up there long, create a term limit then.
Well, if we do term limits, we don't, I think we got to be careful when we do term limits, because okay, someone
said
that
there's
official term limits on people on council.
And then put it to a vote, and
I wouldn't have a problem with that either.
Okay. Put it to a vote, and people speak.
All right, call the vote.
Chang?
No.
Gilliam?
No.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randolph abstain. Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
No.
And Small?
Yes.
So four in the affirmative, one abstention, and four negative. Five vote, resolution fails.
Anything else?
Yes. Okay, we have resolution 62 from new business, which was pulled by Councilman Tibbet.
Which one?
62.
I thought we voted.
No, we made it all council.
Council.
You made it all council, but we voted on.
All right, may I have a motion?
Move it. Second.
Moved by Shabazz, second by Tibbet.
I fully support this. I mean, I think it's a great idea. We have to get our money one way. But do you notice how we'll raise the taxes and they still won't come off some of the money that they've taken? Understand this. From what I understand, last year's room numbers, this is going to raise about $2 million. It's very important that we all stick together and we keep screaming and we're on the state's neck nonstop about that $4.5 million that the county's trying to get extra between the 10 and the 13.8%. I believe it's 13.8%. I may be off the percentage. But it's very important that we stay on top of it, because look what a $2 room tax does. I mean, it's New Jersey. Atlantic City is the highest taxes on rooms as it is. And we got to be competitive. And now we're adding a $2 tax. I support it. But we should be getting it from the money that's already being collected and not doing an additional tax. Nobody likes additional taxes. Because if you remember, when they doubled the $3 toll out there, Philly traffic really stopped quite a bit coming into Atlantic City. So when you raise things, it's difficult. I support it. But remember, we got to stick together. We all fight about things. But this is one we have to stay together and raise holy hell on this money that the county's trying to get, this extra $4 million. Because it's going to come out of the taxpayers' butts here, not the casinos.
Chang?
Yes.
Del Valado?
For the record, I support the reason. I don't support the source, but I say yes.
Gilliam?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
No, sorry.
Yes.
That's nine in the affirmative. executive session.
May I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Move by Marsh, second by Shabazz.
We have one item.
And just council members, before we go to that executive session, we want to take council forward.
We have one item. Andre Corbett for discussion. Chang?
Yes.
Delgado?
Yes.
Helium?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
Randall?
Yes.
Shabazz?
Yes.
Tibbet?
Yes.
And Small?
And out of 10, Mancuso, no.
Eight in the affirmative, one in the negative, in about 10 minutes?
10 minutes.
To adjourn?
Move it.
Hold on. I want to pull on record, right? Hold on. I want to pull on record. Resolution 1D. I want to change the vote from yes to no, please.
1D?
Yeah.
All right, motion to adjourn, please.
Move it.
Move by Marsh, second by Randolph. Adjourn.